pursued the horseman to the north, he slyly stole away and left his men. Whereat the great lord of Northumberland, whose warlike ears could never brook retreat, cheered up the drooping army, and himself, Lord Clifford and Lord Stafford, all abreast, charged our main battle's front, and breaking in were by the swords of common soldiers slain.
Father, Duke of Buckingham was either slain or wounded dangerously. I cleft his beaver with a downright blow. If this is true, Father, behold his blood.
And Father, here's the Earl of Wiltshire's blood, whom I encountered as the battle's joy.
Speak louder for me, and tell them what I did.
Somerset.
Richard hath best deserved of all my sons. But is your grace dead, my lord of Somerset?
Such hope have all the line of John of Gaunt.
Thus do I hope to shake King Henry's head.
And so do I. Victorious Prince of York, before I see thee seated in that throne where now the House of Lancaster usurps, I vow to heaven these eyes shall never close. This is the palace of the fearful king, and this the regal seat. Possess it, York, for it is thine and not King Henry's heirs.
Assist me then, sweet Warwick, and I will, for hither we have broken in by force.
We'll all assist you. He that flies shall die.
Thanks, gentle Warwick. Stay by me, lords, and soldiers, stay and lodge by me this night.
If the king come, offer him no violence, unless he seeks to thrust you out perforce.
The queen this day here holds a parliament, but little thinks we will be of her council. By words or blows, here let us win our right.
Armed as we are, let's stay within this house.
A bloody parliament shall this be called, unless Plantagenet, Duke of York, be king, and bashful Henry deposed, whose cowardice hath made us bywords to our enemies.
Then leave me not, my lords, be resolute. I mean to take possession of my rights.
Neither the king nor he that loves him best, the proudest he that holds up Lancaster, dare stir a wing if Warwick shake his bells. I'll plant Plantagenet. Root him up who dares. Resolve thee, Richard. Claim the English crown.
My lords, look where this sturdy rebel sits, even in the chair of state. Belike he means, backed by the power of Warwick, that false peer, to aspire unto the crown and reign as king. Earl of Northumberland, he slew thy father, and thine, Lord Clifford, and you both have vowed revenge on him, his sons, his favorites, and his friends.
If I be not, heavens be revenged on me.
Oh, Perloth makes Clifford mourn and steal. What? Shall we suffer this?
Let's pluck him down.
My heart for anger burns. I cannot brook it.
Be patient, gentle Clifford.
Patience is for poltroons, such as he. He durst not sit there had your father lived. My gracious liege, here in the parliament, let us assail the family of York.
Well hast thou spoken, cousin. Be it so.
Ah, know you not the city favors them, and they have troops of soldiers at their beck?
But when a duke is slain, they'll quickly fly.
Far be the thought of this from Henry's heart to make a shambles of the Parliament House. Cousin of Exeter, frowns, words, and threats shall be the war that Henry means to use. Thou factious Duke of York, descend my throne and kneel for grace and mercy at my feet. I am thy sovereign.
I am thine.
For shame, come down. He made thee Duke of York.
Was mine by inheritance, as the earldom was.
Ah, my father was a traitor to the crown.
Exeter, thou art a traitor to the crown in following this usurping Henry.
Whom should he follow but his natural king?
True, Clifford. And that's Richard, Duke of York.
And shall I stand and thou sit in my throne?
It shall and must be so. Content thyself.
Be Duke of Lancaster. Let him be king.
He is both king and Duke of Lancaster.
And Warwick shall disprove it. You forget that we are those that chased you from the field and slew your fathers, and with our colors spread, marched through the city to the palace gates.
Yes, Warwick, I remember to my grief, and by his soul thou and thy house shall rue it. Plantagenet, of thee, these thy sons, thy kinsmen, and thy friends, I'll have more lives than drops of blood were in my father's veins.
Urge it no more.
Lest that instead of words, I send thee, Warwick, such a messenger as shall avenge his death before I stir.
Poor Clifford, how I scorn his worthless threats.
Will you we show our title to the crown? If not, our swords will plead it in the field.
What title hast thou, traitor, to the crown? Thy father was as thou art, Duke of York. Thy grandfather, Roger Mortimer, Earl of March. I am the son of Henry V, who made the dolphin and the French to stoop
and seized upon their towns and provinces.
Talk not of France, if thou hast lost it all.
The Lord Protector lost it, and not I. When I was crowned, I was but 9 months old.
You are old enough now, and yet methinks you lose. Father, tear the crown from the usurper's head.
Sweet father, do so. Set it on your head.
Good father, as thou lovest and honorest arms, let's fight it out, to not stand cavilling thus.
Sound drums and trumpets, and the king will fly.
Sons, peace!
Peace thou, and give King Henry leave to speak.
Plantagenet shall speak first. Hear him, lords, and be you silent and attentive too, for he that interrupts him shall not live.
Thinkst thou that I will leave my kingly throne, wherein my father and my grandfather sat? No. First shall war unpeople this my realm, I and their colors, often born in France. And now in England, to our heart's great sorrow, shall be my winding sheet. Why, faint you, lords? My title's good and better far than his.
Prove it, Henry, and thou shalt be king.
Henry the Fourth, by conquest, got the crown.
'Twas by rebellion against his king.
I know not what to say. My title's weak. Tell me, may not a king adopt an heir?
What then?
And if he may, then I am lawful king. For Richard, in view of many lords, resigned the crown to Henry the Fourth, whose heir my father was, and I am his.
He rose against him, being his sovereign, and made him to resign the crown perforce.
Suppose, lords, that he did it unconstrained. Think you it were prejudicial to his crown?
No, for he could not so resign the crown, but that the next heir should succeed and reign.
Exeter, art thou against us?
His is the right, and therefore pardon me.
Why, whisper you, my lords, and answer not.
My conscience tells me he is lawful king.
All will revolt from me and turn to him.
Plantagenet, for all the claims thou layest, think not that Henry shall be so deposed.
Deposed he shall be, in despite of all.
Thou art deceived. 'Tis not thy southern powers of Essex, Norfolk, Suffolk, nor of Kent, which makes thee thus presumptuous and proud, can set the Duke up in despite of me.
King Henry, be thy title right or wrong,
Lord Clifford vows to fight in thy defense. May that ground gape and swallow me alive when I shall kneel to him that slew my father.
Oh, Clifford, how these words revive my heart.
Henry of Lancaster, resign thy crown. Why mutter you, and what conspire you, lords?
Do right unto this princely Duke of York, or I will fill the room with armed men, and all the chair of state where now he sits, write up his title with usurping blood.
My lord of Warwick, hear me but one word.
Let me for this my lifetime reign as king.
Confirm the crown to me and to mine heirs, and thou shalt reign in quiet while thou livest.
I am content. Richard Plantagenet, enjoy the kingdom after my decease.
What wrong is this unto the prince, your son?
What good is this to England and himself?
Base, fearful, and despairing Henry.
How hast thou injured both thyself and us? I cannot stay to hear these articles.
Nor I.
Come, cousin. Let us tell the queen these news.
Farewell, faint-hearted and degenerate king, in whose cold blood no spark of honor abides.
Be thou a prey unto the house of York, and die in bands for this unmanly deed.
Dreadful war mayest thou be overcome, or live in peace abandoned and despised.
Turn this way, Henry, and regard them not.
They seek revenge, and therefore will not yield.
Ah, Exeter.
Why should you sigh, my lord?
Not for myself, Lord Warwick, but my son, whom I shall unnaturally disinherit. But be it as it may, I here resign the crown to thee and to thine heirs forever, conditionally that here thou take an oath to cease this civil war, and whilst I live to honor me as thy king and sovereign, and neither by treason nor hostility to seek to put me down and reign thyself.
This oath I willingly take and will perform.
Long live King Henry! Plantagenet, embrace him!
And long live thou, and these thy forward sons.
Now York and Lancaster are reconciled.
Accursed be he who seeks to make them foes.
Farewell, the gracious lord. I'll to my castle.
And I'll keep London with my soldiers.
And I into the sea from which I came.
And I with grief and sorrow to the court.
Here comes the queen whose looks bewray her anger. I'll steal away.
Exeter, so will I.
Nay, go not from me. I will follow thee.
Be patient, gentle queen, and I will stay.
Who can be patient in such extremes? Oh, wretched man, would I had died a maid and never never seen thee, never borne thee, son, seeing thou hast proved so unnatural a father. Hath he deserved to lose his birthright thus? Hadst thou but loved him half so well as I, thou felt the pain which I did for him once, or nourished him as I did with my blood. Thou wouldst have left thy dearest heartblood there, rather than have made that savage duke thine heir, and disinherited thine only son.
Father, you cannot disinherit me. If you be king, why should not I succeed?
Pardon me, Margaret. Pardon me, sweet son.
The Earl of Warwick and the Duke enforced me.
Enforced thee? Art thou king, and wilt be forced? I shame to hear thee speak. Oh, timorous wretch, thou hast undone thyself, thy son, and me, and given unto the house of York such head as thou shalt reign but by their sufferance, to entail him and his heirs under the crown. What is it but to make thy sepulchre and creep into it far before thy time? Warwick is Chancellor and Lord of Calais. Stern Falconbridge commands the narrow seas. The Duke is made protector of the realm. And yet shalt thou be safe? Such safety finds the trembling lamb environed with wolves. Had I been there, which am a silly woman, the soldiers would have tossed me on their pikes before I would have granted that act. But thou preferest thy life before thine honor. And seeing thou dost, I here divorce myself both from thy table, Henry, and thy bed, until that act of Parliament be repealed whereby my son is disinherited. The northern lords that are forsworn thy colors will follow mine if once they see them spread. And spread they shall be, to thy foul disgrace and the utter ruin of the House of York. Thus do I leave thee. Come, son, away. Our army's ready. Come, we'll after them.
Say, gentle Margaret, hear me speak.
Thou hast spoke too much already. Get thee gone.
Gentle son Edward, thou wilt stay with me.
I'd be murdered by his enemies.
When I return with victory from the field, I'll see your grace. Till then, I'll follow her.
Come, son, away. We may not linger thus.
Poor queen. Her love to me and to her son hath made her break out into terms of rage. Revenge she may be on that hateful duke, whose haughty spirit winged with desire will cost my crown, and like an empty eagle tire on the flesh of me and of my son. The loss of those two lords torments my heart.
I'll write unto them and entreat them fair. Come, cousin, you shall be the messenger.
And I hope, shall reconcile them all.
Oh, I be youngest, give me leave.
No, I can better play the orator.
But I have reason strong and forcible.
Now, my loving sons, are you at strife? What is your quarrel? How began it first?
No quarrel, but a slight contention.
About what?
About that which concerns your grace and us. The crown of England, father, which is yours.
Mine, son? Not till King Henry be dead.
Your right depends not on his life or death.
Now you are heir, therefore enjoy it now.
By giving
the House of Lancaster leave to breathe, it will outrun you, father, in the end.
I took an oath that he should quietly reign.
But for a kingdom, any oath may be broken. Why, I would break 1,000 oaths to reign 1 year.
Oh, God forbid your grace should be forsworn.
I shall be if I claim by open war.
I'll prove the contrary if you'll hear me speak.
Thou canst not, son. It is impossible.
An oath is of no moment, being not sworn before a true and lawful lord that hath authority over him that swears. Henry had none, but did usurp the place. Then, seeing 'twas he that made you to depose, your oath, my lord, is vain and frivolous apple to arm.
And, father, do but think how sweet a thing it is to wear a crown, within whose circuit is Elysium, and all that poets feign of bliss and joy. Why do we linger thus? I cannot rest until the white rose I wear be dyed even in the lukewarm blood of Henry's heart.
Richard, enough. I shall be king or die. Son George, you shall to London presently and wet on Warwick to this enterprise. Thou, Richard, shall unto the Duke of Norfolk and tell him privily of our intent. You, Edward, shall unto my lord of Cobham, with whom the Kentishmen will willingly arise.
In them I trust, for they are soldiers, witty, liberal, courteous, full of spirit. And while you are thus employed, what resteth more but I seek occasion how to rise? And yet the king, not privy to my drift, nor any of the house of Lancaster. Now stay, what news? Why come you in such post?
The queen, with all the northern earls and lords, intend here to besiege you in your castle. She is hard by with 20,000 men, and therefore fortify your hold, my lord.
Aye, with my sword? What, thinkest thou we fear them? Richard and Edward, you will stay with me. George, you shall away to London presently, and wet on Warwick to this enterprise. Let him tell him, and noble Cobham and all the rest, prepare themselves with strong policies. And trust not simple Henry, nor his oaths.
Further I go, other when them ferret not.
The army of the queen means to besiege us.
She shall not need, we'll meet her in the field.
But with 5,000 men?
Aye, with 500, father, for a need. A woman's general, what should we fear?
I hear their drums. Let's set our men in order and issue forth and bid the battle straight.
5 men to 20. Though the odds be great, I doubt not, dear sons, of our victory. Many's the battle I have won in France, when as the enemy hath been 10 to 1. Why should I not now have like success?
A Lancaster! A Lancaster!
Chaplain, away! Thy priesthood saves thy life! For the blood of this accursed duke whose father slew my father, he shall die.
I am in Lord Robert in company.
Soldiers, away with him!
Oh, Clifford, murder not this innocent child, lest thou be hated both of God and man.
How now? Is he dead already? Or is it fear that makes him close his eyes? I'll open them. Vain thou speakst, poor boy! My father's blood hath stopped the passage where thy word should enter.
Then let my father's blood open it again. He is a man, and Clifford cope with him.
And I thy brethren here. Their lives and thine were not revenge sufficient for me. No! I digged up thy forefathers' graves, and hung their rotten coffins up in chains. It could not slake mine iron or ease my heart. The sight of any of the house of York is as a fury to torment my soul. Until I root out their accursed line and leave not one alive, I live in hell. Therefore...
Oh, let me pray before I take my death. To thee I pray, sweet Clifford, pity me.
Such pity as my rapier's point affords.
I never did thee harm. Why wilt thou slay me?
Thy father hath.
But 'twas ere I was born. Thou hast one son. For his sake pity me, lest in revenge thereof, since God has judged he be as miserably slay as I, let me live in prison all my days, and when I give occasion of offense, then let me die, for now thou hast no cause.
No cause? Thy father slew my father, therefore die! Plantagenet! I come, Plantagenet! And this thy son's blood cleaving to my blade shall rust upon my weapon, till thy blood congeal with this to make me wipe off both. The army of the queen hath got the field, and all my followers to the eager foe turn back and fly like ships before the wind, or lambs pursued by hunger-starved wolves. My sons, God knows what has bechanced them, but this I know, they have demeaned themselves like men born to renown by life or death. 3 times did George then make a lane to me. Thrice cried, courage, father, fight it out. Full as oft came Edward to my side with purple falchion painted to the hilt and blood of those that had encountered him.
And when the hardiest warriors did retire, Richard cried, "Charge and give no foot of ground," and cried, "A crown or else a glorious tomb, a scepter or an earthly sepulchre." With that we charged again, but out, alas, we barged again. As I have seen a swan with bootless labor swim against the tide and spend its strength with overmatching waves. But hark, the fatal followers do pursue. And I'm weak, cannot fly their fury. But were I strong, I would not shun their fury. Sands are numbered that make up my life. Here must I stay. Here my life must end. Come, bloody Cliffords, rough Northumberland, I dare your quenchless fury to more rage. I am your butt, I abide your shot.
Yield to our mercy, proud Plantagenet.
Aye, to such mercy as his ruthless arm with downright payment showed unto my father. Now Phaeton hath tumbled from his car and made an evening at the noontide prick.
My ashes, as the phoenix, may bring forth a bird that will revenge upon you all. In that hope, I throw my eyes to heaven, scorning the worst you can afflict me with. Now, I come you not, but multitudes and fear.
So cowards fight when they can flee no further. So doves to peck the falcon's piercing talons. So desperate thieves, all hopeless of their lives, breathe out invectives against the officers.
Oh, Clifford, but bethink thee once again, and in thy thoughts o'errun my former time. And if thou canst, for blushing, view this face, and bite thy tongue that slanders him with cowardice, whose frown hath made thee faint and fly ere this.
I will not bandy with thee word for word, but buckle with thee blow twice to one.
Ho, valiant Clifford! For a thousand causes, I would prolong a while the traitor's life. Wrath makes him death, speak not of
him. Ho, Clifford! Do not honor him so much to prick thy finger, though to wound his heart. What valor were it when a cur doth grin for one to thrust his hand between his teeth when he might spurn him with his foot away? It is war's prize to take all vantage. 10 to 1 is no impeach of valor.
Aye. So strives the woodcock with the jig.
So doth the coney struggle in the net.
So triumph thieves on their conquered booty. So true men yield with robbers so o'ermatched.
What would your grace have done unto him now?
Brave warriors, Clifford and Northumberland, come, make him stand upon this molehill here that wrought at mountains with outstretched arms, yet parted but the shadow with his hand. What? Was it you that would be England's king? Was it you that reveled in our parliament and made preachment of your high descent? Where are your mess of sons to back you now? The wanton Edward and the lusty George. And where's that valiant crookback prodigy, Dickie your boy, that with his grumbling voice was wont to cheer his dad in mutinies? Oh, with the rest. Where is your darling Rutland? Look, York! I stained this napkin with the blood that valiant Clifford with his rapier's point made issue from the bosom of the boy. And if thine eyes can water for his death, I give thee this to dry thy cheeks withal! Ha ha! Ha ha ha! Alas, poor York. But that I hate thee deadly, I should lament thy miserable state. I prithee grieve to make me merry, York. What? Hath thy fiery heart so parched thy entrails that not a tear can fall for Rutland's death? Why art thou patient, man? Thou shouldst be mad!
and I to make thee mad, do mock thee thus. Stamp, rave, and fret, that I may sing and dance. Thou wouldst be feed, I see, to make me sport. York cannot speak unless he wear a crown. A crown for York. And lords bow low to him. Hold you his hand, whilst I do set it on. Aye, marry, sir, no, looks he like a king. Aye, this is he that took King Henry's chair. And this is he was his adopted heir. But how is it great Plantagenet is crowned so soon and broke his solemn oath? As I bethink me, you should not be king till our King Henry had shook hands with death. And would you pale your head in Henry's glory and rob his temples of the diadem now in his life against your holy oath? Oh, tis a fault too unpardonable. Off with the crown, and with the crown his head. And whilst we breathe, take time to do him dead.
That is my office, for my father's sake.
Nay, stay. Let's hear what orisons he makes.
She-wolf of France. Worse than wolves of France, stung more poisons than the adder's tooth. How ill-beseeming is it in thy sex to triumph like an Amazonian troll on their woes whom fortune captivates. But that thy face is visor-like, unchanging, made impudent with use of evil deeds, I would essay, proud queen, to make thee blush. Tell thee whence thou camest, of whom derived was shame enough to shame thee, were thou not shameless. Thy father bears the type of King of Naples, of both the Sicils and Jerusalem, yet not so wealthy as an English yeoman. Hath that poor monarch taught thee to insult? It needs not, nor it boots thee not, proud queen, unless the adage must be verified, that beggars mounted run their horse to death. It is beauty that doth oft make women proud. God, he knows thy share thereof is small. It is virtue that doth make them most admired. The contrary makes thee wondered at. It is government that makes them seem divine. The lack thereof makes thee abominable. Thou art as opposite to every good as the Antipodes are unto us, or the South to the Septentrion. Oh, tiger's heart wrapped in a woman's hide, how couldst thou drain the lifeblood of the child to bid the father wipe his eyes withal, and yet be seen to bear a woman's face? Women are soft, mild, pitiful, flexible. Thou stern, obdurate, flinty, rough, remorseless. Bidst thou me rage? Why, now thou hast thy wish. Wouldst have me weep? Why, now thou hast thy will. For raging wind blows up incessant showers. And when the rage allays, the rain begins. These tears are my sweet Rutland's obsequies. And every drop cries vengeance for his death. Gainst you, fell Clifford, and you, proud Frenchwoman.
Shew me, but his passion moves me so that hardly can I check my eyes from tears.
That face of his,
The hungry cannibals would not have touched, would not have stained with blood. But you are more inhuman, more inexorable. Aye, 10 times more than tigers of Hyrcania. See, ruthless queen, a hapless father's tears. This cloth thou dipped in blood of my sweet boy, and I with tears to wash the blood away. Take thou the napkin and go boast of this. And if you tell the heavy story straight, upon my soul, the hearers will shed tears. Aye, even my foes will shed fast-falling tears and say, alas, it was a piteous deed. Take thou the crown, and with the crown, my curse. And in thy need, such comfort come to thee as I now reap at thy two cruel hands. Hard-hearted Clifford, take me from the world. My soul to heaven, my blood upon your heads.
Had he been slaughtered man to all my kin, I would not for my life but weep with him to see how inly sorrow grips his soul.
What? Weeping right, my lord Northumberland? Think but upon the wrong he did us all, and that will quickly dry thy melting tears.
Here's for my own heart. Here's for my father's death.
And here's to right our gentle-hearted king.
Open thy gates of mercy, glorious God. My soul flies through my wounds to seek out thee.
Off with his head! And set it on York's gates, that York may overlook the town of York.
How our princely father escaped, or whether he'd escaped away enough from Clifford's and Northumberland's pursuit.
Had he been tamed, we should have heard the news.
Had he been slain, we should have heard the news. Or had he escaped, he thinks we should have heard the happy tidings of his good escape. How fares my brother? Why is he so sad?
I cannot joy until I be resolved where our right valiant father is become. I saw him in the battle range about, and watched him how he singled Clifford forth. I thought he bore him in the thickest troop as doth a lion in a herd of neat, or as a bear encompassed round by dogs, who having pinched a few and made them cry, the rest stand all aloof and bark at him. So fared our father with his enemies. So fled his enemies, my warlike father. Methinks 'tis prize enough to be his son.
See how the morning opes her golden gates and takes her farewell of the glorious sun. How well resembles it the prime of youth, trimmed like a yunker prancing to his love.
Dazzle mine eyes, or do I see three sons?
Three glorious sons. Each one a separate son. Not separated with the racking clouds, but severed in a pale, clear, shining sky. See? See, they join, embrace, and seem to kiss as if they vowed some league inviolable. Now are they but one lamp, one light, one sun. In this the heaven figures some event.
It is wondrous strange. The like yet never heard of.
I think it cites us, brothers, to the field, that we, the sons of brave Plantagenet, each one already blazing by our means, should notwithstanding join our lights together and overshine the earth as this the world. Whate'er it bodes, henceforward will I upon my target bear three fair shining sons. Nay, bear three daughters, rather. By your leave, I speak it. You'll have the breeder better than the male.
One of those heavy look foretells some dreadful story hanging on thy tongue.
One that was a woeful looker on,
when as the noble Duke of York was slain, your princely father and my loving lord.
Speak no more. I heard too much.
Say how he died, for I will hear it all.
Environed he was with many foes, and stood against them, as the hope of Troy against the Greeks that would have entered Troy. But Hercules himself must yield to odds, and many strokes, though with a little axe, used down and fells the hardest timbered oak. By many hands your father was subdued, but only slaughtered by the ireful arm of unrelenting Clifford. And the queen, who crowned the gracious duke in high despite, laughed in his face. And when with grief he wept, the ruthless queen gave him to dry his cheeks a napkin, steep it in the harmless blood of sweet young Rutland, by rough Clifford slain. And after many scorns, many foul taunts, they took his head, and on the gates of York they set the same, and there it doth remain, the saddest spectacle that e'er I viewed.
Sweet Duke of York, our prop to lean upon, now thou art gone, we have no staff, no stay.
Oh, Clifford, boisterous Clifford! Thou hast slain the flower of Europe for his chivalry, and treacherously hast thou vanquished him, for hand to hand he would have vanquished thee.
Now is my soul's palace become a prison. Oh, would she break from hence that this my body might in the ground be closed up in rest. For never henceforth shall I see more joy. Never, oh, never shall I joy again.
I cannot weep, for all my body's boisterous care serves to quench my furnace-burning heart. Nor can my tongue unload my heart's great burden. For self-same wind that I should speak with all is kindling coals that fires all my breast and burns me up with flames that tears would quench. To weep is to make less the depth of grief. Tears then for babes, blows and revenge for me. Richard, I bear thy name. I'll avenge thy death or die renowned by attempting it.
His name that valiant duke hath left with thee. His dukedom and his chair with me is left.
Nay, if thou be that princely eagle's bird, show thy descent by gazing against the sun. For chair and dukedom, throne and kingdom, say, either that were thine or else thou wert not his.
On now, fair lord. What fare? What news abroad?
Great lord of Warwick, we should recount our baleful news, and at each word's utterance stab poignards in our flesh till all were told. The words would add more anguish than the wounds. Valiant lord, the Duke of York is slain.
Warwick. Warwick, that Plantagenet which held thee dearly as a soul's redemption is by the stern Lord Clifford done to death.
10 days ago I drowned these news in tears, and now to add more measure to your woes, I come to tell you things sit then befallen. After the bloody fray at Wakefield Fort, where your brave father breathed his latest gasp, tidings as swiftly as the post could run were brought me of your loss and his depart. I then in London, keeper of the king, mustered my soldiers, gathered flocks of friends, and very well appointed, as I thought, marched toward St. Albans to intercept the queen, bearing the king in my behalf along. For by my scouts I was advertised that she was coming, with a full intent to dash our late decree in Parliament touching King Henry's oath and your succession. Your tale to make. We at St. Albans met, our battles joined, and both sides fiercely fought. But whether it was the coldness of the king, who looked full gently on his warlike queen, that robbed my heated soldiers of their spleen, or whether it was reports of her success, or more than common fear of Clifford's rigor, who thunders to his captive's blood and death, I cannot judge. But to conclude with truth, their weapons like the lightning came and went. Our soldiers, like the night owl's lazy flight, or like a lazy thresher with a flail, fell gently down, as if they struck their friends. I cheered them up with justice of our cause, with promise of high pay and great reward. But all in vain, they had no heart to fight, and we in them no hope to win the day, so that we fled. Yet now I join with you, for in the marches here we heard you were making another head to fight again.
Where is the Duke of Norfolk, gentle Warwick?
Some 6 miles off the Duke is with the soldiers.
But in this troublous time, what shall be done? Shall we go throw away our coats of steel and wrap our bodies in black mourning gowns, numbering our added merries with our beads? Or
shall we on the helmets of our foes tell our devotion with revengeful arms? If for the last say I am to it,
why, therefore, Warwick came to seek you out. Attend me, lords. The proud insulting queen, with Clifford and the hot Northumberland, and up their feather many more proud birds, have wrought the easy melting king like wax. He swore consent to your succession, his oath enrolled in the parliament. And now to London, all the crew are gone to frustrate both his oath and what beside may make against the house of Lancaster. Their power, I think, is 30,000 strong. Now, if the help of Norfolk and myself, together with those friends that thou, brave Earl of March, amongst the loving Welshmen canst procure, will but amount to 25,000, why, via to London we will march amain, and once again bestride our foaming steeds, and once again cry, charge upon our foes, but never once again turn back and fly.
Aye, now methinks I hear great Warwick speak. Ne'er may he live to see a sunshine day that cries retire if Warwick bid him stay.
Warwick, on thy shoulder will I lean, and when thou failst, as God forbid the hour, must Edward fall, which peril heaven forfeit.
No longer Earl of March, but Duke of York. The next degree is England's royal throne. For King of England shalt thou be proclaimed in every borough as we march along. And he that throws not up his cap for joy shall for the fault pay forfeit with his head. Stay we no longer dreaming of renown, but sound the trumpets and about our task.
Then, Clifford, were thy heart as hard as steel, as thou hast shown it flinty by thy deeds, I come to pierce it or give thee mine.
Then strike up, drums! God and St. George for us.
On our news.
The Duke of Norfolk sends word by me. The Queen is coming with a puissant host and craves your company for speedy counsel.
Why then in sorts? Brave warriors, let's away!
Welcome, my lord, to this brave town of York. Yonder's the head of that arch enemy that sought to be encompassed with your crown. Doth not the object cheer your heart, my lord?
Aye, as rocks cheer them that fear their wreck. To see this sight, it irks my very soul. Withhold revenge, dear God, 'tis not my fault, nor wittingly have I infringed my vow.
My gracious liege! This too much lenity and harmful pity must be laid aside. To whom do lions cast their gentle looks? Not to the beast that would usurp their den. Whose hand is that the forest bear doth lick? Not his that swells her young before her face. Who slips the lurking serpent's mortal sting? Not he that sets his foot upon her back. The smallest worm will turn being trodden on, and doves will peck in safeguard of their brood. Ambitious York did level at thy crown, thou smiling while he knit his angry brows. He but a duke would have his son a king, and raise his issue like a loving sire. Thou being a king, blessed with a goodly son, didst still consent to disinherit him, which argued thee a most unloving father. Unreasonable creatures feed their young, and though man's face be fearful to their eyes, yet in protection of their tender ones, who has not seen them, even with those wings which sometimes they have used with fearful flight, make war with him that climbed into their nest, offering their own lives in the young's defense. For shame, my liege, make them your precedent. Were it not pity that this goodly boy should lose his birthright by his father's fault, and long hereafter say unto his child, what my great-grandfather and grandsire got, my careless father fondly gave away. Oh, what a shame was this. Look on the boy, and let his manly face, which promiseth successful fortune, steal thy melting heart to hold thine own, and leave thine own with him.
Full well hath Clifford played the orator, inferring arguments of mighty force. But tell me, Clifford, didst thou never hear that things ill got had ever bad success? And happy always was it for that son whose father for his hoarding went to hell. I leave my son my virtuous deeds behind. Would my father had left me no more. For all the rest is held at such a rate as brings a thousandfold more care to keep than in possession any jot of pleasure. Ah, cousin York, would thy best friends did know how it doth grieve me that thy head is here.
My lord, Cheer up your spirits. Our foes are nigh, and this soft courage makes our followers faint. You promised knighthood to our forward son. Edward, kneel down.
Edward Plantagenet, arise a knight and learn this lesson. Draw thy sword and write.
My gracious father, by your kingly leave, I'll draw it as apparent to the crown, and in that quarrel, use it to the death.
Boy, that is spoken like a toad, prince.
Royal commanders, be in readiness, for with a band of 30,000 men comes Warwick, backing of the Duke of York, and in the towns as they do march along, proclaims him king. Many fly to him. Derain your battle, for they are at hand.
I would your highness would depart the field. The queen hath best success when you are absent.
Aye, good my lord, leave us to our fortune.
Why, that's my fortune too, therefore I'll stay.
Be it with resolution then to fight.
My royal father, cheer these noble lords, and hearten those that fight in your defense, and sheathe your sword, good father, cry St. George.
Now, perjured Henry, wilt thou kneel for grace and put thy diadem upon my head? Or bide the mortal fortune of the field.
Go rate thy minions, proud, insulting boy. Becomes it thee to be thus bold in terms before thy sovereign and thy lawful king?
I am his king, and he should bow his knee. I was adopted heir by his consent. Since when his oath is broke? For as I hear you that are king, though he do wear the crown, have caused him by new act of parliament to blot out me and put his own son in.
And reason too. Who should succeed the father but the son?
Are you there, butcher? I cannot speak.
Aye, crookback, here I stand to answer thee. Nor any he, the proudest of thy sort.
Was you that killed young Rutland, was it not?
Aye, and old York, and yet not satisfied.
For God's sake, lords, give signal to the fight.
What sayest thou, Henry? Wilt thou yield the crown?
Why, how now, long tongue, Warwick? Dare you speak? When you and I met at St. Albans last, your legs did better service than your hands.
Why, then 'twas my turn to fly, and now 'tis thine.
You said so much before, and yet you fled.
Was not thy valor, Clifford, drove me thence?
No, nor your manhood durst make you stay.
Northumberland, I hold thee reverently. Break off this parley. For scarce can I refrain the execution of my big swollen heart upon that Clifford, that cruel child killer.
I slew thy father. Call'st thou him a child?
Aye, like a dastard and a treacherous coward. And thou didst kill our tender brother Rutland. But ere sunset I'll make thee curse the deed.
The lords have done with words and hear me speak.
Defy them then, or else hold close thy lips.
I prithee give no limits to my tongue. I am a king and privileged to speak.
My liege, the wound that bred this meeting here cannot be cured with words. Therefore be still.
Then, executioner, unsheathe thy sword. By him that made us all, I am resolved that Clifford's manhood lies upon his tongue.
Say, Henry, shall I have my right or no? 1,000 men have broke their fast this day that ne'er shall dine unless thou yield the crown.
If thou deny, their blood be on thy head, for York in justice puts his armor on.
If that be right which Warwick says is right, there is no wrong, but everything is right.
Whoever got thee there, thy mother stands, for well I wot thou hast thy mother's tongue.
But thou art neither like thy sire nor dam, but like a foul, misshapen, stigmatic, marked by the destinies to be avoided, as venom toads or lizards' dreadful stings.
Iron of Naples, hid with English guilt, whose father bears the title of a king, as if a channel should be called the sea. Shamest thou not, knowing from whence art extract, to let thy tongue detect thy base-born heart?
A wisp of straw were worth 1,000 crowns to make this shameless callet know herself. Helen of Greece was fairer far than thou, although thy husband may be Menelaus. And ne'er was Agamemnon's brother wronged by that false woman as this king by thee. His father reveled in the heart of France and tamed the king and made the dolphin stoop. And had he matched according to his state, he might have kept that glory to this day.
But when he took a beggar to his bed and graced thy poor sire with his bridal day, even then that sunshine brewed a shower for him that washed his father's fortunes forth from France and heaped sedition on his crown and home. For what hath broached this tumult but thy pride? Hadst thou been meek, our title still had slept, and we, in pity of the gentle king, had slipped our claim until another age.
But when we saw our sunshine made thy spring, and that thy summer bred us no increase, we set the axe to thy usurping roots. And though the edge had something hid ourselves, yet know thou, since we have begun to strike, we'll never leave till we have hewn thee down or bathed thy groin with our heated blood.
And in this resolution I defy thee, not willing any longer conference, since thou deniest the gentle king to speak. Sound trumpets, let our bloody colors wave, and either victory or else a grave.
Stay, Edward!
No, wrangling woman, I'll no longer stay. Thy words will cost 10,000 lives this day.
Spent with toil. As runners with a race, I might lay me down a little while to breathe. For strokes received and many blows replayed have robbed my strong knit sinews of their strength. Spite of spites, I needs must rest a while.
Smile, gentle heaven, for strike comes gentle death. This world frowns and Edward's sun is clouded.
How now, fair lords? What happened? What hope of good?
Our hap is lost. Our hope but sad despair. Our ranks are broken, ruin follows us. What counsel give you? Whither shall we fly?
Hopeless is flight, for they follow us with wings, and weak we are and cannot shun pursuit.
Warwick, why hast thou withdrawn thyself? My brother's blood the thirsty earth hath drunk, broached with the steely point of Clifford's lance. And in the very pangs of death, like a dismal clang I heard from far, he cried, Warwick, revenge! Brother, revenge my death! So underneath the belly of their steeds that stained their fetlocks in his smoking blood, the noble gentleman gave up the ghost.
Then let the earth be drunken with our blood. I'll kill my horse because I will not fly. Why stand we like soft-hearted women here wailing our losses whilst the foe doth rage? Or look upon as if the tragedy were played in jest by counterfeiting actors. Here on my knee, I vow to God above, I'll never pause again, never stand still, till either death hath closed these eyes of mine, or fortune given me measure of revenge.
Warwick, I do bend my knee with thine, and in this vow do chain my soul to thine.
And ere my knee rise from the earth's cold face, I throw mine eyes, my hands, my heart to thee, thou setter up and plucker down of kings. Beseeching thee, if with thy will it stands that to my foes this body must be prey, yet that thy brazen gates of heaven will ope and give sweet passage to my sinful soul. Now, lords, take leave until we meet again, where'er it be, in heaven or in earth.
Brother, give me your hand. Gentle Warwick, let me embrace thee in my weary arms. I that did never weep, now melt with woe that winter should cut off our springtime's.
Away, away, once more, sweet lords, farewell.
Yet let us all together to our troops, and give them leave to fly that will not stay, and call them pillars that will stand to us. And if we thrive, promise them such rewards as victors wear at the Olympian Games. This may plant courage in their quailing breasts, for yet is hope of life and victory. For slow no longer, make we answer may!
This for young Rutland slain, both bound to revenge with our empire and with a brazen wall.
Now, Richard, I am with thee here alone. This is the hand that stabbed thy father York, and this the hand that slew thy brother Rutland. And here's the heart that triumphs in their death, and cheers these hands that slew thy sire and brother to execute the like upon thyself. And so have it thee.
Thank you.
yourself to death.
This battle fares like to the morning's war, when dying clouds contend with growing light. What time the shepherd, blowing of his nails, can neither call it perfect day nor night, now sways it this way like the mighty sea, forced to retire the fury of the wind. Now sways it that way like the selfsame sea. Sometime the flood prevails, and then the wind. Now one the better, then another best. Both tugging to be victor breast to breast, yet neither conqueror nor conquered. So is the equal poise of this fell war. To whom God will, there be the victory. For Margaret, my queen, and Clifford too, have chid me from the battle, swearing both they prosper best of all when I am thence. Would I were dead if God's good will were so. For what is in this world but grief and woe? O God, methinks it were a happy life to be no better than a humbly swain, to carve our dials quaintly, point by point, to see the minutes how they run, how many make the hour full complete, how many hours bring about the day, how many days fill up the year, how many years a mortal man may live. When this is known, then to divide the times. So many hours must I tend my flock, so many hours must I take my rest, so many hours must I contemplate, so many hours must I sport myself. So many days my youths have been with young, so many weeks ere the poor fools will e'en, so many years ere I shall shear the fleece. So minutes, hours, days, months, and years, passed over to the end they were created, would bring white hairs into a quiet grave. What a life were this! How sweet, how lovely! Gives not the hawthorn bush a sweeter shade to shepherds looking on their silly sheep than doth a rich embroidered canopy to kings that fear their subjects' treachery? Oh, yes, it doth, a thousandfold it doth. And to conclude, the shepherd's homely curds, his cold, thin drink out of his leather bottle, his wonted sleep under a fresh tree shade, all which secure and sweetly he enjoys, is far beyond a prince's delicates, his viands sparkling in a golden cup, his body couched in a curious bed. When care, mistrust, and treason waits on him.
Ill blows the wind that profits no man. This man whom hand to hand I slew in fight may be possessed of some store of crown. And I, that happily take them from him now, may yet ere night yield both my life and them to some man else, as this dead man doth me. Who's this?
Oh God! It's my father's face, whom I in this conflict unawares have killed. Oh, heavy times begetting such events. From London by the king was I pressed forth. My father, being the Earl of Warwick's man, came in the part of York, pressed by his master. And I, who at his hands received my life, have by my hands of life bereaved him. Oh, pardon, God, but I knew not what I did. And pardon, Father, but I knew not thee. My tears shall wipe away these bloody marks, and no more words till they weep their fill.
Oh, piteous spectacle. Oh, bloody times. Whilst lions war and battle for their dens, poor harmless lambs abide their enmity. Weep, wretched man. I'll aid thee tear for tear, and let our hearts and eyes like civil war be blind with tears and break or charged with grief.
Now that so stoutly hast resisted me, give me thy gold. If thou hast any gold, for I have bought it with 100 blows. But let me see, is this our foeman's face?
No, it is my only son. Oh boy, if any life be left in thee, throw up thine eye. See what showers arise, blown with the windy tempest of my heart upon thy wounds, that kills my eye and heart. Oh, pity! God, this miserable age! What stratagems, how fell, how butcherly, erroneous, mutinous, and unnatural this deadly quarrel daily doth beget. Oh boy, thy father gave thee life too soon, and hath bereft thee of thy life too late.
Woe above woe. Grief more than common grief. Would that my death would stay these ruthful deeds. Pity. Pity, gentle heaven, pity. The red rose and the white are on his face, the fatal colors of our striving houses. The one is purple blood right well resembles, the other his pale cheeks methinks presenteth. Wither one rose, and let the other flourish. If you contend, 1,000 lives must wither.
How will my mother, for a father's death, take on with me and ne'er be satisfied?
How will my wife, for slaughter of my son, shed seas of tears and ne'er be satisfied?
How will the country, for these woeful chances, misthink the king and not be satisfied?
Was ever son so rued a father's death?
Was ever father so bemoaned his son?
Was ever king so grieved for subject's care? Much is your sorrow, mine 10 times so much.
I'll bear thee hence, where I may weep my fill.
These arms of mine shall be thy winding sheet. My heart, sweet boy, shall be thy sepulcher, for from my heart thine image ne'er shall go. My sighing breast shall be thy funeral bell, and so obsequious will thy father be, him for the loss of thee having no more, as Priam was for all his valiant sons. I'll bear thee hence. And let them fight that will, for I have murdered where I should not kill.
With care. Here stands a king more woeful than you are.
Fly, father, fly, for all your friends are fled, and Warwick rages like a chafed bull. Away, for death doth hold us in pursuit.
Mount, my lord, towards Berwick, post to Maine. Edward and Richard, like a brace of greyhounds, having the fearful flying hare in sight, with fiery eyes sparkling for very wrath, and with bloody steel grasped in their ireful hands, are at our backs. Therefore, hence to Maine.
Away! For vengeance comes along with them. Nay, stay not to expostulate. Make speed, or come after. I'll away before.
Nay, good Northumberland, take me with thee. Not that I fear to stay, but love to go whither the queen intends. Forward away.
Here burns my candle up. Aye, here it dies. While as it lasted gave King Henry life. Oh, Lancaster, I fear my overthrow more than my body's parting with my soul. I love and fear brewed many friends today. Now I'll call thy tuftful mixture melts, impairing Henry, strengthening misproud York. The common people swarm like summer flies, and whether fly the gnats but to the sun, and who shines now but Henry's enemies?
Oh, Phoebus, hast thou never given consent that fair to check thy fiery steeds, thy burning power? Never had scorched the earth. And Henry, didst thou swayed as king should do, or as thy father and his father did, giving no ground unto the house of York? They never then had sprung like summer flies. Aye, and 10,000 in this luckless realm had left no mourning widows for our death. And thou this day hadst kept thy chair in peace. For what doth cherish wheat but gentle air? And what makes robbers bold but too much lenity?
Hopeless our claims. And cureless are my wounds. No way to fly. No strength to hold our flight. Those merciless will not pity. For at their hands I have deserved no pity. The air hath got into my deadly wound, and much effuse of blood doth make me faint. Come, York and Richard, Warwick and the rest, I stab thy father's bosoms, split my breast.
We lords, good fortune bids us pause and smooth the frowns of war with peaceful looks. Some troops pursue the bloody-minded queen, but led calm Henry, though he were a king, as doth a sail filled with a fretting gust command an argosy to stem the waves. But think you, lords, that Clifford fled with them?
No, 'tis impossible he should escape, for though before his face I speak the words, your brother Richard marked him for the grave, and wheresoever he is, he's surely dead.
Whose soul is that takes our heavy leave?
Deadly groan like life and death's departing.
See who it is. And now the battle's ended, if it be friend or foe, let him be gently used.
Revoke that doom of mercy for this Clifford.
Do not consider that he'll out the branch, you know him rappling when his leaves put forth. But set his murdering knife unto the root from whence that tender spray did sweetly spring. I mean our princely father, Duke of York.
From off the gates of York, take down the head. Your father's head, which Clifford placed there, instead whereof, let this supply the room. Measure for measure must be answered.
So lies that fatal screech owl to our house, that nothing sung but death to us and ours. Now death shall stop his dismal threatening sound, and his ill-boding tongue no more shall speak.
I think his understanding is bereft. Speak, Clifford. Dost thou know who speaks to thee? Dark cloudy death o'ershades his beams of life, and he nor sees nor hears us what we say.
Would he did, and so perhaps he doth. 'Tis but his policy to counterfeit, because he would avoid such bitter taunts which in the time of death he gave our father.
If so thou think'st, vex him with eager words.
Clifford, ask mercy and obtain no grace.
Clifford, repent in bootless penitence. Clifford, devise excuses for thy faults.
While we devise fell tortures for thy faults.
Thou didst love York, and I am son to York.
Thou pitiest Rutland, I will pity thee.
Where is Captain Margaret to fence you now?
I mock thee, Clifford. Swear as thou wast wont.
Oh, it's not an oath! The world goes hard when Clifford cannot spare his friends an oath. I know by that he's dead. By my soul, if this right hand would buy 2 hours' life that I and all this fight might rail at him, this hand should chop it off. And with the issuing blood, stifle the villain, whose unstaunched thirst York and young Rutland could not satisfy.
Aye, but he's dead. Off with the traitor's head, and rear it in the place your father stands. And now to London with triumphant march, there to be crowned England's royal king. From whence shall Warwick cut the seas to France to ask the Lady Bona for thy queen? Thus shalt thou sinew both these lands together, and having France thy friend, thou shalt not dread the scattered foe which hopes to rise again. For though they cannot greatly sting to hurt, yet look to hear them buzz to offend thine ears. First will I see thy coronation, and then to Brittany across the seas to effect this marriage. So it please my lord.
Even as thou wilt, sweet Warwick, let it be. For in thy shoulder do I build my seat, and never will I undertake that thing wherein thy counsel and consent is wanting. Richard, I will create thee Duke of Gloucester,
George of Clarence. Warwick, as ourselves, shall do or undo as him pleaseth best.
Let me be Duke of Clarence, George of Gloucester. For Gloucester's dukedom is too ominous.
That's a foolish observation. Richard, be Duke of Gloucester. And now to London, to see these honors in possession.
Into this thick grown brake will make our stand, and through the land and on the deer will come. Now in this cupboard will we stay, cut on the principle of all the deer.
I'll stay by the heels, so both may shoot.
That cannot be. The noise of thy crossbow will scare the herd, and so my shoot is lost. Now here stand we both, and aim we at the best. And that the time shall not seem tedious, I'll tell thee what befell me on a day in this self spot where now we mean to stand.
Here comes a man. Let's stay till he be passed.
From Scotland am I stolen, even of pure love, to greet mine own land with my wishful sight. No, Harry. Harry, 'tis no land of thine. Thy place is filled, thy scepter wrung from thee, thy balm washed off wherewith thou wast anointed. No bending knee will call thee Caesar now. No humble suitors press to speak for right. No, not a man comes for redress of thee. For how can I help them and not myself?
Why, here's a deer who skins a keeper's feet. This is the quondam king. Let's seize him.
Let me embrace the sour adversities. For wise men say it is the wisest course.
Forbear a while. Let's hear a little more.
Queen and son are gone to France for aid. And as I hear, the great commanding Warwick is thither gone to crave the French king's sister to wife for Edward. If this news be true, poor queen and son, your labor is but lost. For Warwick is a subtle orator, and Lewis a prince soon won with moving words. By this account, then, Margaret may win him. For she's a woman to be pitied much. Her sighs will make a battery in his breast. Her tears will pierce into a marble heart. The tiger will be mild while she does mourn, and Nero will be tainted with remorse to hear and see her plaints, her brinish tears. Aye, but she's come to beg Warwick to give. She on his left side, craving aid for Henry. He on his right, asking a wife for Edward. She weeps and says her Henry is deposed. He smiles and says his Edward is installed. That she, poor wretch, for grief can speak no more. Whilst Warwick tells his title, smooths the wrong, inferreth arguments of mighty force, and in conclusion wins the king from her, with promise of his sister, and what else, to strengthen and support King Edward's place. Aye, Margaret, thus twill be. And thou, poor soul, art then forsaken as thou wentst forlorn.
Say what thou art that talk'st of kings and queens.
More than I seem, and less than I was born to. A man, at least, men may talk of kings, and why not I?
Thou talk'st as if thou wert a king.
Why, so I am, in mind, and that's enough.
Well, if you be a king, where is your crown?
My crown is in my heart, not on my head. Not decked with diamonds and with Indian stones, nor to be seen. My crown is called contempt, and a crown it is that seldom kings enjoy.
Well, if you be a king, crowned with content, your crown content and you must be contented to go with us. For as we think, you are the king King Edward has disposed. And we, his subjects, sworn in all allegiance, will apprehend you as his enemy.
But did you never swear and break an oath?
No, never so great an oath, nor will not now.
Where did you dwell when I was king of England?
Why, here in this country, where we now remain.
I was anointed king when I was but 9 months old. My father and my grandfather were kings, and you were sworn true subjects unto me. And tell me, then have you not broke your oaths?
No, for we were subjects but while you were king.
Why, am I dead? Do I not breathe a man? Simple men, you know not what you swear. Look, as I blow this feather from my face, and as the air blows it to me again, obeying with my wind when I do blow, obeying another when it blows, commanded always by the greater gust, such is the likeness of you common men. But do not break your oaths, for of that sin my mild entreaty shall not make you guilty. Go where you will. Your king shall be commanded. Be you kings, command, and I'll obey.
We are loyal subjects unto the king. King Edward.
So would you be again to Henry if he were seated as King Edward is.
We command you in God's name and the king's to go with us unto the officer.
In God's name lead, your king's name be obeyed. And what God will, that let your king perform. And what he will, I humbly yield unto.
Brother of Gloucester, at St. Albans Field, this lady's husband, Sir Richard Grey, was slain. His lands then seized by the conquerors. Her suit is now to repossess those lands, which we in justice cannot well deny, because in quarrel of the House of York, the worthy gentleman did lose his life.
Your Honor, would we do well to grant her suit? It were dishonor to deny
it. It were no less. But yet, I'll make a pause.
Yea, is it so? I see the lady hath a thing to grant before the king will grant her humble suit.
He knows the game, how true he keeps the wind.
Silence.
Widow, we will consider of your suit. Come some other time to know our mind.
Right gracious lord, I cannot brook delay. May it please your highness to resolve me now, and what your pleasure is shall satisfy me.
Aye, widow. Then I'll warrant you all your lands, and if what pleases him shall pleasure you, fight close or a faith you'll catch a blow.
I fear not unless she jumps to fall.
God forbid that, for he'll take bandages.
How many children hast thou, widow?
I think he means to beg a child of her.
Nay, whip me then, he'll rather give her to.
Three, most gracious lord.
You shall have four if you be ruled by him.
'Twere pity they should lose their father's lands.
Be pitiful, dread lord, and grant it then.
Lords, give us leave. I will try this widow's wit.
Aye, good leave have you. For you will have leave to youth take leave and leave you to the crutch.
Now tell me, madam, do you love your children?
Aye, full as dearly as I love myself.
And would you not do much to do them good?
To do them good, I would sustain some harm.
Then get your husband's lands to do them good.
Before I came unto your majesty.
I'll tell you how those lands are to be got.
So shall you bind me to your highness' service.
What service wilt thou do me if I give them?
What you command. That rests in me to do.
But you'll take exception to my boon.
No, gracious lord. Except I cannot do it.
Aye, thou canst do what I mean to ask.
Then I will do what you command.
Life's hard and much rain wears the marbles.
It's red as fire. Nay, then her wax must melt.
Shall I not hear my task? Why stops my lord?
An easy task. 'Tis but to love a king.
That's soon performed, because I am a subject.
Why, then thy husband's lands I freely give thee.
I take my leave with many thousand thanks.
The match is made, she seals it with a curtsy.
But stay thee. 'Tis the fruits of love, I mean.
Tis the fruits of love I mean, my liege.
Aye, but I fear me in another sense. What love thinkst thou I sue so much to get?
My love till death, my humble thanks, my prayers. That love which virtue begs and virtue grants.
No, I did not mean such a love.
Then you mean not as I thought you did.
But now you partly may perceive my mind.
My mind will never grant what I perceive your highness aims at, if I aim aright.
To tell thee plain, I aim to lie with thee.
To tell you plain, I had rather lie in prison.
Why, then thou shalt not get thy husband's lands.
Then shall mine honesty be my dower, for by that loss I will not purchase them.
Therein thou wrongst thy children mightily.
Therein your highness wrongs both them and me. But, mighty lord, this merry inclination accords not with the sadness of my suit. Please to dismiss me either with aye or no.
Aye, if thou wilt say aye to my request. No, if thou dost say no to my demand.
Then, no. My suit is at an end.
We don't like him not, she needs her brow.
He's the bluntest wooer in Christendom.
Her looks do argue her replete with modesty. Her words do show her wit incomparable. All her perfections challenge sovereignty. And one way or other, she is for a king. And she shall be my love. Or else my queen. Say that King Edward take thee for his queen.
That's better said than done, your majesty. I am a subject fit to jest withal, but far unfit to be a sovereign.
Sweet widow, by my state I swear to thee, I speak no more than what my soul intends, and that is to enjoy thee for my love.
And that is more than I shall yield to. I know I am too mean to be your queen, but yet too good to be your concubine.
You cavil, widow. I did mean my queen.
'Twill grieve your grace my son should call you father.
No more than when my daughters call you mother. Thou art a widow, and thou hast some children. And by God's mother, I, being but a bachelor, have other sons. Why, it is a happy thing to be the father unto many sons. Answer no more, for thou shalt be my queen.
The ghostly father now hath done his shrift.
When he was made a shriver, 'twas for shift.
Brothers, you muse what chat we two have had.
The widow likes it not. She looks very sad.
You'd think it strange if I should marry her?
To whom, my lord?
Why, Clarence, to myself.
Well, that would be 10 days' wonder at the least.
That's a day longer than a wonder lasts.
By so much is the wonder in extremes.
Well, jest on, brothers. I can tell you both, her suit is granted for her husband's lands.
My gracious liege, Henry your IV is taken and brought your prisoner to your palace gate.
See that he be conveyed from the tower. And go away, brothers, to the man that took him to question of his apprehension. Widow, go you along. Lords, use her honorably.
Aye, Edward will use women honorably. Would he were wasted, marrow, bones, and all, that from his loins no hopeful branch may spring to cross me from the golden time I look for. And yet, between my soul's desire and me, the lustful Edward's title buried, is Clarence, Henry, and his son, young Edward, and all the unlooked-for issue of their loins to take their rooms ere I can place myself. A cold premeditation for my purpose. Why, then I do but dream on sovereignty, like one who stands upon a promontory and spies afar off shore where he would tread, wishing his foot were equal with his eye, and chides the sea that sunders him from thence, saying he laid it dry to have his way. So do I wish the crown being so far off. And so I chide the means that keeps me from it. And so I say I'll cut the causes off, flattering me with impossibilities. My eyes too quick, my heart o'erweens too much. Unless my hand and strength could equal them. Well, say there is no kingdom then for Richard. What other pleasure can the world afford? I'll make my heaven in a lady's lap, and deck my body in gay ornaments, and with sweet ladies, with my words and looks. Oh, miserable thought. More unlikely.
quickly than to accomplish 20 golden crowns. My love forswore me in my mother's womb. And for I should not deal in her soft laws, she did corrupt frail nature with some bribe to shriek by an arm of like a withered shrub. To make an envious mountain on my back where sits deformity, to mock my body, to shape my legs of an unequal size, to disproportion me in every part like to a chaos, or an unlicked bear whelp that carries no impression like the dam. And am I then a man to be beloved? No monstrous fault to harbor such a thought. Then, since this earth affords no joy to me but to command, to check, to overbear such as are a better person than myself, I'll make my heaven to dream upon the crown. And whiles I live to account this world but hell, until my misshaped trunk that bears this head be round impaled with a glorious crown. And yet I know not how to get the crown. For many lives stand between me and home. And I, like one lost in a thorny wood, that rends the thorns and is rent with the thorns, not knowing how to find the open air, but toiling desperately to find it out, torment myself to catch the English crown. And from that torment, I will free myself, or hew my way out with a bloody axe. Smile and murder whiles I smile, and cry content to that which grieves my heart, and wet my cheeks with artificial tears, and frame my face to all occasions. I'll drown more sailors than the mermaid shall. I'll slay more gazers than the basilisk. I'll play the orator as well as Nestor. Deceive more slyly than Ulysses could. Like a Sidon, take another Troy. I can add colors to the chameleon. Change shapes with Proteus for advantage. And set the murderous Marcuvel to school. Can I do all this and cannot get a crown? Were it further off, I'll pluck it down.
Fair Queen of England, worthy Margaret, sit down with us. It ill befits thy birth and state that thou should stand while Louis doth sit.
No, mighty King of France, now Margaret must strike her sail and learn a while to serve where kings command. I was, I must confess, great Albion's queen in former golden days, but now mischance hath trod my title down, and with dishonor laid me on the ground, where I must take like seat unto my fortune, and to my humble seat conform myself.
I say, fair queen, whence springs this deep despair?
Such a cause as fills mine eyes with tears and stops my tongue, while heart is drowned in tears.
Whate'er it be thou still like thyself, and sit thee by our side. Yield not thy neck to fortune's yoke, but let thy dauntless mind still ride in triumph over all mischance. Be plain, Queen Margaret, and tell thy grief. It shall be eased if France can yield relief.
Those gracious words revive my drooping thoughts, and give my tongue-tied sorrows leave to speak. Now, therefore, let it be known to noble Louis that Henry, sole possessor of my love, is of a king become a banished man and forced to live in Scotland or forlorn, while proud, ambitious Edward, Duke of York, usurps the regal title and the seat of England's true anointed lawful king. This is the cause that I, poor Margaret, with this my son, Prince Edward, Henry's heir, am come to crave thy just and lawful aid. And if thou failest, All our hope is done. Scotland hath will to help, but cannot help. Our people and our peers all misled, our treasure seized, our soldiers put to flight. And as thou seest, ourselves in heavy plight.
Redoubted queen, with patience calm the storm, whilst we bethink a means to break it off.
The more we stay, the stronger grows our foe.
The more I stay, the more I'll succor thee.
Oh, but in patience waiteth on true sorrow. And see where comes the breeder of my sorrow.
What sea approacheth boldly to our presence?
An Earl of Warwick, Edward's greatest friend.
Welcome, brave Warwick. What brings thee to France?
I now begin the second storm to rise, for this is he that moves both wind and tide.
From worthy Edward, King of Albion, my lord and sovereign, and thy vowed friend, I come in kindness and unfeigned love. First do greeting to thy royal person, and then to crave a league of amity, and lastly to confirm that amity in nuptial knot. If thou vouchsafe to grant that virtuous Lady Bona, thy fair sister, to England's king in lawful marriage.
If that go forward, Henry's hope is done.
And gracious madam, on my king's behalf I am commanded, with your leave and favor, humbly to kiss your hand. And with my tongue to tell the passion of my sovereign's heart, where fame, late entering at his heedful ears, hath placed thy beauty's image and thy virtue.
King Louis and Lady Bona, hear me speak before you answer, Warwick. His demand springs not from Edward's well-meant, honest love, but from deceit bred by necessity. For how can tyrants safely govern home, unless abroad they purchase great alliance? To prove him tyrant, this reason may suffice, that Henry liveth still. But were he dead, yet here Prince Edward stands, King Henry's son. Look therefore, Lewis, that by this league and marriage you draw not on thy danger and dishonor. For the usurpers sway the rule awhile. Heavens are just, and time suppresseth wrong.
Injurious Margaret!
And why not queen?
Because thy father Henry did usurp, and thou no more art prince than she is queen.
Then Warwick disannuls great John of Gaunt, which did subdue the greatest part of Spain. And after John of Gaunt, Henry the Fourth, whose wisdom was a mirror to the wisest, and after that wise prince, Henry the Fifth, who by his prowess conquered all of France. From these does our Henry lineally descend.
Oxford, how haps it in this smooth discourse? You told not how Henry the Sixth hath lost all that which Henry the Fifth had gotten. Methinks these peers of France should smile at that. But for the rest, you tell a pedigree of 62 years. A silly time to make prescription for a kingdom's worth.
Why, Warwick, canst thou speak against thy liege whom thou obeyst 36 years and not bewray thy treason with a blush?
Can Oxford, that did ever fence the right, now buckler falsehood with a pedigree? For shame, leave Henry and call Edward king.
Call him my king, by whose injurious doom my elder brother, the Lord Aubrey Vere, was done to death, and more than so, my father. Even in his mellowed years, when nature had brought him to the door of death. No, Warwick, no. While life upholds this arm upholds the house of Lancaster.
And I, the house of York.
Queen Margaret, Prince Edward at Oxford, vouchsafe at our request to stand aside, whilst I use further conference with Warwick.
Heavens grant that Warwick's words bewitch it not.
Now, Warwick, tell me, even upon thy conscience, is Edward your true king? For I would loathe to leap with him that were not lawful chosen.
Thereon I pawn my credit and mine honor.
But is he gracious in the people's eye?
The more that Henry was unfortunate.
Then, Warwick, further dissembling set aside, tell us for truth the measure of his love unto our sister Bona.
Such it seems as would beseem a monarch like himself. Myself have often heard him say and swear that this his love is an eternal plant, whereof the root is fixed in virtue's ground. The leaves and fruit maintained with beauty's sun, exempt from envy, but not from disdain, unless the Lady Bona quit his pain.
And now, fair sister, let us hear your firm resolve.
Your grant or your denial shall be mine. Yet I confess that often ere this day, when I have heard your king's deserts recounted, mine ear hath tempted judgment to desire.
Then, Warwick, thus, our sister shall be Edward's. And now must articles be drawn, touching the jointure which your king must make
with which her dowry shall be counterpoised.
Draw near, Queen Margaret, and be a witness that Bona shall be wife unto the English king.
To Edward, but not to the English king.
Deceitful Warwick! It was thy device by this alliance to make void my suit. Before thy coming, Lewis was Henry's friend.
And still is friend to him and Margaret.
But if your title to the crown be weak, as may appear by Edward's good success, then 'tis but reason that I be released from giving aid which late I promised. Yet shall you have all kindness at my hand that your estate requires and mine can yield.
Henry now lives in Scotland at his ease, where having nothing, nothing can he lose. But as for you yourself, our quondam queen, you have a father able to maintain you, and better 'twere you troubled him than France.
Peace, impudent and shameless Warwick, peace! Proud setter up and puller down of kings, I will not hence do with my talk and my tears, both full of truth. I make King Louis behold thy sly conveyance and thy lord's false love, for both of you are birds of self-same feather.
Warwick, this is some post to us of thee.
My lord ambassador, these letters are for you, sent from your brother, Marquis Montague. These from our king unto your majesty.
And madam, these for you, from whom I know not.
I like it well that our fair queen and mistress smiles at her news, while Warwick frowns at his.
Nay, mark how Lewis stamps as he were nettled. I hope all's for the best.
Warwick, what is thy news? And yours, fair queen?
Mine, such as fill my heart with unhoped joy.
Mine, full of sorrow and heart's distress.
What, is your king married the Lady Grey? And now to soothe your forgery, he sends me papers to persuade me patience. Is this the alliance that he seeks with France? Dare he presume to scorn us in this manner?
I told your majesty as much before. This proveth Edward's love. And Warwick's honesty.
King Lewis, I here protest in sight of heaven and by the hope I have of heavenly bliss that I am clear of this misdeed of Edward's. No more my king, since he dishonors me, but most himself, if he could see his shame. Did I forget that by the house of York my father came untimely to his death? Did I let pass the abuse done to my niece? Did I impale him with the regal crown? Did I put Henry from his native seat? And am I girded at the last with shame? Shame on himself. My desert is honor. And to repair my honor lost for him, I here renounce him. And return to Henry, my gracious queen. Let former grudges pass, and henceforth I am thy true servitor. Thou will revenge his wrong to Lady Bona, and replant Henry in his former state.
Warwick, these words have turned my hate to love, and I forgive and quite forget old faults. Enjoy that thou becomest King Henry's friend.
So much his friend, ay, his unfeigned friend, that if King Lewis will vouchsafe to furnish us with some few bands of chosen soldiers, I'll undertake to land them on our coast and force the tyrant from his seat by war. Is not his new-made bride shall succor him. And as for Clarence, as my letters tell me, he's very likely now to fall from him for matching more for want and lust than honor, or than for strength and safety of our country.
Dear brother, how shall Bona be revenged but by thy help to this distressed queen?
Renowned prince, how shall poor Henry live unless thou rescue him from foul despair?
My quarrel and this English queen's are one.
And mine, fair Lady Bona, joins with yours.
And mine with thine and Margaret's and hers. At last I firmly am resolved. You shall have aid.
Let me give humble thanks for all at once.
That England's messenger return in post and tell thy supposed king, the false Edward, that Louis of France is sending over maskers to revel it with him and his new bride. Thou seest what's past? Go, fear thy king with all.
Tell him in hope he'll prove a widower shortly, or wear the willow garland for his sake.
Tell him my mourning weeds are laid aside, and I'm ready to put armor on.
Tell him from me that he hath done me wrong, and therefore I'll uncrown him ere it be long. There's thy reward. Begone.
But Warwick, thou and Oxford shall with 5,000 men cross the seas and bid false Edward battle.
And as occasion serves, this noble queen and prince shall follow with a fresh supply. But ere thou goest, answer me one doubt. What bond have we of thy firm loyalty?
This shall assure my constant loyalty, that if our queen and this young prince agree, I'll give my eldest daughter and my joy to him forthwith in holy wedlock bands.
Yes, I agree. And thank you for your motion. Son Edward, she is fair and virtuous. Therefore, delay not. Give thy hand to Warwick, and with thy hand, thy faith irrevocable that only Warwick's daughter shall be thine.
Yes, I accept her, for she well deserves it, and here to pledge my vow I give my hand.
Then why stand we here? The forces shall be levied. I long till Edward fall by war's mischance. A mocking marriage with a dame of France.
I came from Edward as ambassador, but I return his sworn and mortal foe. Matter of marriage was the charge he gave me. The dreadful war shall answer his demand. Had he none else to make a stale but me, then none but I shall turn his jest to sorrow. I was the chief that raised him to the crown, and I'll be chief to pull him down again. Not that I pity Henry's misery, but for revenge on Edward's mockery.
Now tell me, Brother Clarence, what think you of this new marriage to the Lady Grey? Hath not the king made a worthy choice?
Alas, you know, 'tis far from hence to France. How could he stay till Warwick made return?
My lords, forbear this talk. Here comes the king and his well-chosen bride.
I mind to tell him plainly what I think.
Now, Brother Clarence, how like you our choice, that you stand pensive as half malcontent?
As well as Louis of France or the Earl of Warwick, which are so weak of courage and in judgment that they'll take no offense at our abuse.
Suppose they take offense without a cause. They are but Louis and Warwick. I am Edward, your king and Warwick's, and must have my will.
And shall have your will because our king. Yet hasty marriage seldom proveth well.
Yea, Brother Richard, art thou offended too?
Not I. No, God forbid that I should wish them severed whom God hath joined together. And 'twere pity to sunder them that yoke so well together.
Setting your scorns and your mislike aside, tell me some reason why the Lady Grey should not become my wife and England's queen. You too, Somerset and Montague, speak freely what you think.
This is mine opinion. That King Louis becomes our enemy for mocking him about the marriage of the Lady Bonner.
And Warwick, doing what you gave in charge, is now dishonored by this new marriage.
What if Louis and Warwick be appeased by such invention as I can devise?
Yet to have joined with France in such alliance would more have strengthened this our commonwealth against foreign storms than any homebred marriage.
Why, knows not Montague that of itself England is safe if true within itself?
Yes, but it is safer still when backed with France.
It is better using France than trusting France. Let us be backed with God, and with the seas which he hath given us for fence impregnable, and with their helps only defend ourselves. In them and in ourselves our safety lies.
For this one speech, the Lord Hastings well deserves to have the heir of the Lord Hungerford.
Aye, what of that? It was my will and grant.
And for this once my will shall stand for law.
And yet methinks your grace hath not done well to give the heir and daughter of the Lord Scales unto the brother of your loving bride. For she better would have fitted me or Clarence. But in your bride you bury brotherhood.
Or you would not have bestowed the heir of the Lord Bonville on your new wife's son, and leave your brothers to go speed elsewhere.
Alas, poor Clarence. Is it for a wife that thou art malcontent?
I will provide thee.
In choosing for yourself, you showed your judgment. Which being shallow, you shall give me leave to play the broker in mine own behalf. And to that end, I shortly mind to leave you.
Leave me or tarry. Edward will be king, and not be tied unto his brother's will.
My lords, before it pleased his majesty to raise my state to title of a queen, do me but right, and you must all confess that I was not ignoble of descent, and meaner than myself have had like fortune. But as this title honors me and mine, So your dislike, to whom I would be pleasing, doth cloud my joys with danger and with sorrow.
My love, forbear to fawn upon their frowns. What sorrow or what danger can befall thee so long as Edward is thy constant friend?
And their true sovereign, whom they must obey, nay, whom they shall obey, and love thee too, unless they seek for hatred at my hands, which if they do, yet will I keep thee safe, and they shall feel the vengeance of my wrath.
I hear, but say not much, yet think the more.
Now, messenger, what letter, what news from France?
My sovereign needs no letters and few words, but such as I, without your special pardon, dare not relate.
Go to, we pardon thee. Therefore, in brief, tell us their words, as near as thou canst guess them. What answer makes King Louis unto our letters?
Go tell false Edward, thy supposed king, that Louis of France is sending over maskers to revel it with him and his new bride.
Is Louis grown so brave? Belike he thinks me Henry. But what said Lady Bona to my marriage?
Tell him in hope he'll prove a widower shortly. I'll wear the willow garland for his sake.
I blame not her. She could say little less. She had the wrong. But what said Henry's queen?
Tell him, quoth she, my mourning weeds are laid aside, and I am ready to put armor on.
Oh, belike she minds to play the Amazon. But what said Warwick to these injuries?
He, more incensed against your majesty than all the rest, discharged me with these words. Tell him for me that he hath done me wrong, and therefore I'll uncrown him at the law.
Curse the traitor breathe so proud words! But I'll arm me, being thus forewarned, they shall have war and pay for their presumption. But say, is Warwick friends with Margaret?
Aye, gracious sovereign, they are so linked in friendship that young Prince Edward marries Warwick's daughter.
Like the elder, Clarence will have the younger. Now, brother king, farewell, and sit you first, for I will hence to Warwick's other daughter, that though I want a kingdom, yet in marriage I may not prove inferior to yourself. You that love me and Warwick, follow me!
Not I. My thoughts aim at a further matter. I stay not for the love of Edward, but the crown.
Clarence and Somerset both gone to Warwick.
Yet am I armed against the worst can happen. And haste is needful in this dreadful case. Stafford, you on our behalf, go levy make men and make prepare for war. They are already or quickly will be landed. Myself in person straight will follow you. But ere I go, Hastings, Montague, resolve my doubt. You twain of all the rest are near to Warwick, both by blood and by alliance. Then tell me if you love Warwick more than me. If it be so, then both depart to him. I rather wish you foes than hollow friends. But if you mind to hold your true obedience, give me assurance with some friendly vow that I may never have you in suspect.
So God help Montague as he proves.
And Hastings as he favors Edward's cause.
No, brother Richard. Will you stand by us too?
Aye, in despite of all that shall withstand you.
Why so? Then am I sure of victory. Therefore let us hence, and lose no hour till we meet with Warwick and his foreign power.
Trust me, my lord. All hitherto goes well. The common people by numbers swarm to us. Let's see where Somerset and Clarence come. Speak suddenly, my lords. Are we all friends?
Fear not that, my lord.
Then welcome, gentle Clarence, unto Warwick. And welcome, Somerset. I hold it cowardice to rest mistrustful when the noble heart hath pawned an open hand in sign of love. Else might I think that Clarence, Edward's brother, were but a feigned friend to our proceedings. But welcome, sweet Clarence. Thy daughter shall be mine. And now, what rests but in knight's coverture? Thy brother being carelessly encamped, his soldiers lurking in the towns about and but attended with a simple guard, that we surprise and take him at our pleasure. Our scouts have found the adventure very easy, that is Ulysses and stout Diomede with sleight and manhood stole Doresa's tent and brought from thence the Thracian fatal steeds. So we, well covered with the knight's black mantle, at unawares may beat down Edward's guard and seize himself. I say not slaughter him, for I intend but only to surprise him.
you that will follow me in this attempt. Applaud the name of Henry with your leader, and then let's on our way in silent sort. For Warwick and his friends, God and St. George.
Man, take his stand. The king by this has set him down to sleep.
What, will he not to bed?
Why, no, for he hath made a solemn vow never to lie and take his natural rest till Warwick or himself be quite suppressed.
Tomorrow, then, belike shall be the day, if Warwick be so near as men report. But why commands the king that his chief followers lodge in towns around him while he himself keeps in the cold field?
'Tis the more honorable, because the more dangerous.
Why, but give me worship and quietness. I like it better than a dangerous honor. If Warwick knew in what estate he stands, 'tis to be doubted he would waken him.
Unless our halberds did shut up his passage.
Aye, wherefore else guard we his tent, but depend his person from nightfalls.
This is his tent, and see where stands his guard. Courage, my masters. Honor now or never. But follow me, and Edward shall be ours. Who goes there?
Paladinus!
Here is the Duke.
The Duke?
Why, Warwick, when we parted last, thou calledst me king.
Aye, but the case is altered. When you disgraced me in my ambassade, then I degraded you from being king, and come now to create you Duke of York. Alas, how should you govern any kingdom that know not how to use ambassadors, nor how to be contented with one wife,
nor how to use your brothers brotherly, nor how to study for the people's welfare, nor how to shroud yourself from enemies.
Yea, brother of Clarence, art thou here too? Nay, then I see that Edward needs must down. But Warwick, know that in spite of all mischance, of thee, thyself, and all thy accomplices, Edward will always bear himself as king. Though fortune's malice overthrow my state, my mind exceeds the compass of her wheel.
Then for his mind, be Edward England's king. But Henry now shall wear the English crown and be true king indeed, thou but his shadow.
The Lord of Somerset,
at my request, see that forthwith Duke Edward be conveyed unto the Archbishop of York, my brother. When I have fought with Pembroke and his fellows, I'll follow you. And tell what answer Lewis and the Lady Bonner send to him. Now, for a while, farewell, good Duke of York.
What fates impose, that men must needs abide. It boots not to resist both wind and tide.
What now remains for us to do, my lord, but to march toward London with our soldiers?
That's the first thing that we have to do, to free King Henry from imprisonment and see him seated on the regal throne.
My dearest Ellen, are you yet to learn the late misfortunes befallen King Edward?
What, loss of some pitched battle against Warwick?
No, but loss of his own royal person.
Then is my sovereign slain?
Aye, almost slain, for he is taken prisoner. Either betrayed by falsehood of his guard, or by his foes surprised at unawares. And as I further have to understand, is new committed to the Bishop of York, fell Warwick's brother, and by that our foe.
Oh, these news, I must confess, are full of grief. Yet, gracious madam, bear it as you may. Warwick may lose it now hath won the day.
Till then, fair hope must hinder life's decay. And either rather wean me from despair for love of Edward's offspring in my womb. This is it that makes me bridle passion and wear with mildness my misfortune's cross. Aye, for this I draw in many a tear and stop the rising of blood-sucking sighs. Lest with my sighs or tears I blast or drown King Edward's fruit, true heir to the English crown.
But, madam, where has Warwick then become?
I'm informed he comes towards London to set the crown once more on Henry's head. Guess thou the rest. Edward's friends must down. But to prevent the tyrant's violence, for trust not him that once hath broken faith, I'll henceforth with to the sanctuary to save at least the heir of Edward's right. There shall I rest secure from force and fraud. Come. Let us fly where we may fly. If Warwick take us, we are sure to die.
My lord, haste me. Leave off to wonder why I threw you into this chiefest thicket of the park. Thus stands the case. You know the king, my brother, is prisoner to the bishop here, in whose hands he has good usage and great liberty, and often will come in with weak guards from hunting this way to disport himself. I have advertised him by secret means that about this hour he make his way under the color of his usual game. Here shall he find his friends with horse and men to set him free from his captivity.
This way, my lord, for this way lies the game.
Nay, this way, man. See where the huntsmen stand. Standst thou thus close to steal the bishop's deer?
Well, there's a time and case required of haste. Your horse stands ready at the park corner.
But whither shall we then?
To Lynn, my lord, and ship from thence to Flanders.
Well, guest, believe me, for that was my meaning.
Hastings, I will requite thy forwardness.
Wherefore stay, we choose no time to talk.
What sayest thou, huntsman? Wilt thou come along?
Oh, better do so than tarry behind.
Then away, let's have no more ado.
Bishop, farewell. Shield me from Warwick's frown, and pray that I may repossess the crown.
Master Lieutenant, now that God and friends have shaken Edward from the regal seat, turn my captive state to liberty, my fears to hope, my sorrows unto joys, at our enlargement, what are thy due fees?
Subjects may challenge nothing of their sovereigns. But if an humble prayer may prevail, I then crave pardon of your majesty.
For what, Lieutenant? The will using me? Nay, be thou sure I well requite thy kindness, for that it made my imprisonment a pleasure. Ay, such a pleasure as encaged birds conceive, when after many moody thoughts, at last by notes of household harmony, they quite forget their loss of liberty. But Warwick, after God thou setst me free, and therefore chiefly I thank God and thee. He was the author, thou the instrument. Therefore that I may conquer fortune's spite, by living low where fortune cannot hurt me, and that the people of this blessed land shall not be punished with my thwarting stars. Warwick, although my head still wear the crown, I here resign my government to thee, for thou art fortunate in all thy deeds.
Your grace hath still been famed for virtuous, and now may seem as wise as virtuous by spying and avoiding fortune's malice, for few men temper rightly with the stars. But in this one thing let me blame your grace for naming me when Clarence is in place.
No, Warwick. Thou art worthy of the sway to which the heavens in thy nativity adjudged an olive branch and laurel crown, as likely to be blessed in peace and war. And therefore, I yield thee my free consent.
And I choose Clarence only for protector.
Warwick and Clarence, give me both your hands. Now join your hands, and with your hands your hearts. Let no dissension hinder government, I make you both protectors of this land, while I myself will lead a private life, and in devotion spend my latter days to sin's rebuke and my Creator's praise.
What says Clarence to his sovereign's will?
That he consents, if Warwick yield consent, for on thy fortunes I repose myself.
Why then, though loath, yet must I be content. We'll yoke together, like a double shadow to Henry's body, and supply his place, I mean in bearing weight of government, while he enjoys the honor and his ease. And Clarence, now it is more than needful that forthwith Edward be proclaimed a traitor and all his lands and goods be confiscated.
What else? And that succession be determined.
Aye, therein Clarence shall not want his part.
But with the first of all your chief affairs, let me entreat, for I command no more, that Margaret your queen and my son Edward be sent for to return from France with speed. For till I see them here, by doubtful fear, my joy of liberty is half eclipsed.
It shall be done, my sovereign, with all speed.
My lord of Somerset, what youth is that of whom you seem to have so tender care?
My liege, it is young Henry, Earl of Richmond.
Come hither, England's hope. If secret powers suggest but truth to my divining thoughts, this pretty lad will prove our country's bliss. His looks are full of peaceful majesty. His head by nature framed to wear a crown, his hand to wield a scepter, and himself likely in time to bless a regal throne. Make much of him, my lords, for this is he must help you more than you are hurt by me.
Unsavory news.
But Edward is escaping from your brother and fled as he hears since to Burgundy.
Unsavory news. But how did he escape?
He was conveyed by Richard, Duke of Gloucester, and the Lord Hastings, who attended him in secret ambush on the forest side. And from the bishop's huntsman rescued him, for hunting was his daily exercise.
My brother was too careless of his charge. But let's away, my sovereign, to provide a salve for any sore that may betide.
My lord, I like not of this flight of Edward's. But doubtless Burgundy will yield him help, and we shall have more wars before it be long. As Henry's late presaging prophecy did glad my heart with hope for this young Richmond, so doth my heart misgive me in these conflicts what may befall him to his harm and ours. Therefore, Lord Oxford, to prevent the worst, forthwith we'll send him hence to Brittany, till storms be past of civil enmity.
Aye. For if Edward repossess the crown, his life at Richmond with the rest shall die.
It shall be so. He shall to Brittany. Come, therefore, let's about it speedily.
Now, Brother Richard, Lord Hastings, and the rest, yet thus far fortune maketh us amends. And says that once more I shall interchange my wane and state for Henry's regal crown. Well have we passed and now repassed the seas and brought desired help from Burgundy. What then remains, we being thus arrived from Ravensquare Haven before the gates of York, but that we enter in as into our dukedom.
The gates are closed. Brother, I like not this. For many men that stumble at the threshold are well foretold that danger lurks within.
Tush, man, abodements must not now affright us. By fair or foul means we must enter in. For hither will our friends repair to us.
My liege, I'll call once more to summon them.
My lords, we were forewarned of your coming, and shut our gates for safety of ourselves. For now we owe allegiance unto Henry.
But, Master Mayor, if Henry be your king, yet Edward, at the least, is Duke of York.
True, my good lord. I know you for no less.
Why, then I challenge nothing but my dukedom, as being well content with that alone.
When the fox hath once got in his nose, he'll soon find means to make the body follow.
Why, Master Mayor, why stand you in a doubt? Open the gates. We are King Henry's friend.
Aye, say you so. The gate shall then be open.
A wise stout captain, and soon persuaded.
The good old man would feign that all were well, and so 'twere not long of him. But being entered in, I doubt not I, but we shall soon persuade both him and all his brothers unto reason.
Now, Master Mayor, these gates must not be shut but in the night or in the time of war. What, man, fear not, but yield me up the key. For Edward will defend the town and thee, and all those friends that deign to follow me.
Brother, this is Sir John Montgomery, our trusty friend,
unless I be deceived. Welcome, Sir John. But why come you alone?
To help King Edward in his time of storm, as every loyal subject ought to do.
Thanks, brave Montgomery. But we now forget our title to the crown, and only claim our dukedom, till God please to send the rest.
Then fare you well, for I will hence again. I came to serve a king and not a duke. Drummer, strike up and let us march away.
Stay, Sir John, a while, and we'll debate by what safe means the crown may be recovered.
What? Talk you of debating? In a few words, if you'll not here proclaim yourself our king, I'll leave you to your fortune and be gone to keep them back that come to succor you. Why should we fight if you pretend no title?
Brother, wherefore stand you on nice points? When we grow stronger, then we'll make our claim. Till then, 'tis wisdom to conceal our meaning.
Away with scrupulous wit, now arms must rule.
And fearless minds claim soonest under crowns.
Brother, we'll proclaim you out of hand. The fruit thereof will bring you many friends.
Then be it as you will. But 'tis my right. Henry but usurps the diadem.
Aye, now my sovereign speaketh like himself. And now will I be Edward's champion.
Thanks, brave Montgomery. And thanks unto you all. If fortune serve me, I'll requite this forwardness. Now, for this night, let's harbor here in York. And when the morning sun shall raise his car above the border of this horizon, we'll forward towards Warwick and his mates. For well I wot that Henry is no soldier. Ah, froward Clarence, how evil it beseems thee to forsake thy brother and flatter Henry. But be it as it may, we'll meet both thee and Warwick. Come on, brave soldiers, doubt not of the day. And that once gotten,
doubt not the Lord's pay.
What counsel, lords?
Edward from Belgium with hasty Germans and blunt Hollanders
hath passed in safety through the narrow seas, and with his troops doth march amain to London, and many giddy people flock to him.
Let's levy men and beat him back again.
A little fire is quickly trodden out, which being suffered, rivers cannot quench.
In Warwickshire, I have stout-hearted friends, not mutinous in peace, but bold in war. Those will I muster up. And thou, son Clarence, shalt stir up in Suffolk, Norfolk, and in Kent, the knights and gentlemen to come with thee. Thou, brother Montague, in Buckingham, Northampton, and in Leicestershire, shalt find men well inclined to hear what thou commandst. And thou, brave Oxford, wondrous well-beloved in Oxfordshire, shalt muster up thy friends. My sovereign and the loving citizens, like to his isle girt in with the ocean, or modest Dian, circled with the nymphs, shall rest in London till we come to him. Fair lords, take leave, and stand not to reply. Farewell, my sovereign.
Farewell, my Hector, and my Troy's true hope. In sign of truth, I kiss your highness' hand.
Well-minded Clarence, be thou fortunate.
Comfort, my lord, and so I take my leave, and thus seal I my truth, and bid adieu.
Sweet Oxford and my loving Montague, and all at once more a happy farewell.
Farewell, sweet lords, let's meet at Coventry.
Here at the palace will I rest a while. Cousin of Exeter, what thinks your lordship? Methinks the power that Edward hath in field should not be able to encounter mine.
The doubt is that he will seduce the rest.
That's not my fear. My need hath got me fame. I've not stopped mine ears to their demands. No posted off their suits with slow delays. My pity hath been balm to heal their wounds. My mildness hath allayed their swelling griefs. My mercy dried their water-flowing tears. I've not been desirous of their wealth, nor much oppressed them with great subsidies, nor been forward of revenge, though much they erred.
Why then should they love Edward more than me? No, Exeter, these graces challenge grace. For when the lion fawns upon the lamb will never cease to follow him.
A lad is there! Oh,
yeah. Oh, Lord, what shouts these of the shame-faced Henry?
Bear him hence. And once again proclaim us King of England.
You are the fount that makes small brooks to flow. Now stops thy spring. My sea shall suck them dry and swell so much the higher by their ebb. Hence with him to the tower, I will not hear him speak.
Lords, then we are course towards Coventry, where peremptory Warwick now remains. The sun shines hot, but if we use delay, cold-biting winter mars our hope for, eh?
Away betimes before his forces join and take the great grown traitor unawares. Brave warriors, march amain to...
How far hence is thy lord, my honest fellow?
By this at Dunsmore, marching hitherward.
And how far off is our brother Montague? Where is the post that came from Montague?
By this gentry with a puissant power.
And by thy guess, how nigh is Clarence now?
To me some 2 hours hence.
Then Clarence is at hand, I hear his drum.
Fear not, here's my lord. Here Southam lies. The drums your honor hears marches from Warwick.
Who might that be? Well, I can look for friends.
They're at hand, and you shall quickly know.
No trumpet to the walls and sound a parley. See how the surly Warwick mans the wall.
Oh, in deep spite. Hey, sportful Edward, come. How slept our scouts, or how were they seduced that we could have no news of his repair?
Now, Warwick, wilt thou ope the city gates, speak gentle words, and humbly bend thy knee, call Edward king, and at his hands beg mercy, and he shall pardon thee these outrages.
Nay, rather, wilt thou draw thy forces hence? Confess who set thee up and put thee down. Call Warwick patron and be penitent, and thou shalt still be called the Duke of York.
I thought at least he would have said the crown.
Or did he make the jest against his will?
Is not a dukedom, sir, a goodly gift?
Aye, by my faith, for a poor earl to give. I'll do thee service for so good a gift.
'Twas I that gave the kingdom to thy brother.
Well, why then 'tis mine, if but by Warwick's gift.
Thou art no Atlas for so great a weight. And weakling Warwick takes his gift again. And Warwick and Henry is my king. Warwick his subject.
But Warwick's king is Edward's prisoner. And gallant Warwick, do but answer this. What is the body when the head is off?
Alas, the poor Warwick can no more forecast.
But while he sought to steal the singleton, the king was slyly fingered from the deck.
You left poor Henry at the bishop's palace. 10-1, you'll meet him in the tower.
Is even so, and yet you are Warwick still.
Come, Warwick, take the time.
Kneel down.
Nay, when? Right now, or else the iron cools.
I had rather chop this hand off at a blow and with the other fling it in thy face than bear so low a sail to strike to thee.
Sail how thou canst. Have wind and tide thy friend. This hand, fast wound about thy cold black hair, shall, whilst thy head is warm and new cut off, write in the dust this sentence with thy blood. Wind-changing Warwick now can change no more.
Oh, cheerful colors. See where Oxford comes.
Oxford for Lancaster.
The gates are open, let us enter too.
No other foes may set upon our backs. Stand we in good array, for they no doubt will issue on out again and bid us battle. If not, the city being but of small defense, we'll quickly rouse the traitors in the same.
Oh, welcome, Oxford, for we want thy help.
Montague for Lancaster.
Thou and thy brother both shall buy this treason, even with the dearest blood your bodies bear.
The harder match to the greater victory. My mind presageth happy gain and conquest.
Somerset for Lancaster.
Who are thy name? Both Dukes of Somerset have sold their lives under the House of York. Now shall be the third if this sword hold.
And lo, where George of Clarence sweeps along, a force enough to bid his brother battle. In omen upright zeal, the right prevails. More than the nature of a brother's love. Come, Clarence, come. Thou wilt if Warwick call.
Father Warwick, know you what this means? Look. Here I throw my infamy at thee. I will not ruinate my father's house, who gave his blood to lime the stones together and set up Lancaster. Why throwst thou, Warwick, that Clarence is so harsh, so blunt, unnatural, as to bend the fatal instruments of war against his brother and his lawful king? Perhaps thou wilt object my holy oath. To keep that oath were more impiety than Jephthah's when he sacrificed his daughter. I am so sorry for my trespass made, that to deserve well at my brother's hands, I here proclaim myself thy mortal foe, with resolution wheresoe'er I meet thee, as I will meet thee if thou stir abroad, to plague thee for thy foul misleading me. And so, proud-hearted Warwick, I defy thee. And to my brother, turn my blushing cheek. Pardon me, Edward, for I will make amends. And Richard, do not frown upon my faults, for I will henceforth be no more unconstant.
Now welcome more, and 10 times more beloved than if thou never hadst deserved our hate.
Welcome with Clarence. This is brotherlike.
Oh, passing traitor, perjured and unjust.
Now, Warwick, wilt thou leave the town and fight, or shall we beat the stones about thine ear?
Alas, I am not cooped here for defense. I will away to Barnet presently. And bid thee battle, Edward, if thou darest.
Yes,
Warwick. Edward dares and leads the way. Lords to the field. St. George in victory.
Thank you.
die thou there. Die thou and die our fear. For Warwick was a bug that feared us all.
Now, Montague, tip thee first. I seek for thee, that Warwick's bones may keep buying company.
Who is nigh? Come to me, friend or foe, and tell me who is victor, York or Warwick? Why ask I that? My mangled body shows. My blood, my want of strength, my sick heart shows that I must yield my body to the earth. And by my fall, the conquest to my foe. Thus yields the cedar to the axe's edge, whose arms gave shelter to the princely eagle, under whose shade the rampant lion slept, whose top branch overpeered Jove's spreading tree, and kept low shrubs from winter's powerful wind. These eyes, now dimmed with death's black veil, have been as piercing as the midday sun to search the secret treasons of the world. These brows of mine, now filled with blood, were likened oft to kingly sepulchres. For who reigned king but I could dig his grave? And who durst smile when Warwick bent his brow? All my glory smeared in dust and blood. My parks, my walks, my manners that I had, even now forsake me. And of all my land, is nothing left me but my body's ruins. Why? What is pomp, rule, reign, but earth and dust? And live we how we may, yet die we must.
Warwick! Warwick! Wert thou as we are, we might recover all our loss again. The Queen from France has sent a puissant power. Even now we heard the news. Couldst thou fly?
Why, then I would not fly.
Come, Montague. Thou be there, sweet brother. Take my hand and with thy lips holding my sorrow while.
Thou lovest me not. For, brother, if thou didst, thy tears would wash this cold, congealed blood that glues my lips and will not let me speak. Come quickly, Montague, or I am dead.
Warwick! Warwick! Montague hath breathed his last and to the latest gasp cried out for Warwick. And said, commend me to my valiant brother. And more he would have spoke, and more he said. It sounded like a cannon in a vault that mought not be distinguished. But at last I well might hear, delivered with a groan. Oh, farewell, Warwick.
Sweet rest his soul. Fly, lords, and save yourselves. For Warwick bid you all farewell to meet in heaven.
Away! Away and meet the Queen's great power!
And still our fortune keeps an upward course, and we are graced with wreaths of victory.
But in the midst of this bright shining day, I spy a black, suspicious, threatening cloud that will encounter with our glorious sun ere he attain his easeful western bed. I mean, my lords, those powers the Queen hath raised in Gallia have arrived our coast, and as we hear, march on to fight with us.
A little gale will soon disperse that cloud and blow it to the source from whence it came. The very beams will dry those vapors up, for every cloud engenders not a storm.
The Queen is valued 30,000 strong, and Somerset with Oxford fled to her. If she have time to breathe, be well assured her faction will be full as strong as ours.
They are advertised by our loving friends that they do hold their course for Tewkesbury. We, having now the best at Barnet Field, will thither straight, for willingness rids way. And as we march, our strength will be augmented in every county as we go along. And strike up the drum, cry courage and away!
Thank you.
Wise men ne'er sit and wail their loss, but cheerly seek how to redress their harms. What though the mast be now blown overboard, the cable broke, the holding anchor lost, and half our sailors swallowed in the flood? Yet lives our pilot still. Is it meet he should leave the helm, and like a fearful lad with tearful eyes, add water to the sea, and give more strength to that which hath too much, whilst in his moan the ship splits in the rock, which industry and courage might have saved? Oh, what a shame! What a fault were this! Say Warwick was our anchor. What of that? And Montague our topmast. What of that? Our slaughtered friends our tackles. What of these? Why is not Oxford here another anchor, and Somerset another goodly mast? Our friends of France are shrouds and tacklings. And though unskillful, why not Ned and I for once allow the skillful pilot's charge? We will not from the helm to sit and weep, but keep our course, though the rough winds say no from shelves and rocks that threaten us with wreck. As good to chide the waves as speak them fair. And what is Edward but a ruthless sea? What Clarence but a quicksand of deceit? And Richard but a ragged, fatal rock? All these the enemies to our poor bark. Say you can swim? Alas, 'tis but a while. Tread on sand? Why, there you quickly sink. Bestride the rock, the tide will wash you off, or else you famish. That's a threefold death. This speak I, lords, to let you understand, if case some one of you should fly from us, that there's no hope for mercy with the brothers, more than with ruthless ways, with sands and rocks. Why, courage, then! What cannot be avoided? To a childish weakness to lament or fear.
Methinks a woman of this valiant spirit should, if a coward heard her speak these words, infuse his breast with magnanimity and make him naked, foil a man at arms. I speak not this as doubting any man here. For did I but suspect a fearful man, he should have leave to go away betimes, lest in our need he might infect another and make him of like spirit to himself. If any such be here, as God forbid, let him depart now before we need his help.
Women and children of so high a courage and warriors faint, might of perpetual shame. O brave young prince, thy noble grandfather doth live again in thee.
Long mayst thou live and bear his image and renew his glory.
And he that will not fight for such a hope, go home to bed. And like the owl by day, if he arise, be mocked and wondered at.
Thanks, gentle Somerset. Sweet Oxford, thanks.
And take his thanks, that yet hath nothing else.
Prepare you, lords, for Edward is at hand, ready to fight. Therefore, be resolute.
I thought no less, for it is his policy to haste thus fast and find us unprovided.
But he's deceived. We are in readiness.
This cheers my heart to see your forwardness.
Here, fish, we are battle. Hence we will not bat.
Brave followers, yonder stands the thorny wood, which must, by the heaven's assistance and your strength, be by the roots hewn up yet ere night. I know I need add no fuel to your fire, for well I wot ye blaze to burn them out. Give signal to the fight. And to it, lords!
Lords, knights, and gentlemen, what I should say, my tears gainsay. For every word I speak, you see I drink the water of mine eyes. Therefore, no more but this. Henry, your sovereign, is a prisoner to the foe. His state usurped, his realm a slaughterhouse, his subjects slain, his statutes cancelled, and his treasures spent. And yonder is the wolf that makes the spoil. You fight injustice. Then in God's name, lords, be valiant and give signal to the fight.
tumultuous broils. Away with Oxford to Hames Castle straight. For Somerset, off with his guilty head. Take them hence.
I will not hear them speak.
For my part, I'll not trouble thee with words.
Nor I, but stoop with patience to my fortune.
So part we sadly in this troublous world, to meet with joy in sweet Jerusalem.
Is proclamation made that Ulfine's Edward shall have high reward and he his life?
It is. Lower youthful Edward comes.
Ah, bring forth the gallant. Let us hear him speak.
Oh!
What can so young a thorn begin to prick? Edward, what satisfaction canst thou make for bearing arms, stirring up my subjects, and all the trouble thou hast turned me to?
Speak like a subject, proud, ambitious York. Suppose that I am now my father's mouth. Resign thy chair, and where I stand kneel'st thou, whilst I propose the selfsame words to thee, which traitor thou wouldst have me answer to.
Ay, that thy father had been so resolved.
That thou might still have worn the petticoat of Lancaster and not have stolen the breach.
Let Aesop fable in a winter's night. His curse riddle sorts not with this place.
By heaven's brat, I'll plague you for that word.
Aye, thou wast born to be a plague to men.
For God's sake, take away this captive scold.
Nay, take away this scolding crookback, rather.
Cease, willful boy, or I will charm thy tongue.
Unto that lad, thou art too mellow-pit.
I know my duty. You are all undutiful, thou lascivious Edward, and thou perjured George, and thou misshapen Dick. I tell ye all, I am your better, traitors as ye are, and now you serve my father's right and mine. Oh, no!
Take that, the likeness of this railer here!
Sprouse thou! Take that to end thy agony! There's for twitting me with perjury!
Oh, kill me too!
Marry and child!
No, little home!
We have done too much.
Why should she live to fill the world with words?
What, doth she swoon? Use means for her recovery.
Clarence, excuse me to the king, my brother. I'll hence to London on a serious matter, and ere you come, there'll clear some news.
What?
The tower, the tower.
Oh, Ned. Sweet Ned. Speak to thy mother, boy. Canst thou not speak? Oh, traitors! Murderers! They that stabbed Caesar shed no blood at all, did not offend, nor were not worthy blame. If this foul deed were by to equal it, he was a man. This in respect a child. And men ne'er spend their fury on a child. What's worse than murderer, that I may name it? No, no. My heart will burst, and if I speak. And yet I will speak, so that my heart may burst. Butchers and villains! Bloody cannibals! How sweet a plant have you untimely cropped! You have no children, butchers. If you had, the thought of them would have stirred up remorse. But if you ever chanced to have a child, look in his youth to have him so cut off. As deathmen, you have rid this sweet young Britain.
Away with her. Bear her hence perforce.
Nay. Never bear me hence. Dispatch me here. Here, sheathe thy sword. I'll pardon thee by death. But, wilt thou not? Clarence, do it thou.
By heaven, I will not do thee so much ease.
Good, Clarence, do. Sweet Clarence, do thou do it.
Didst thou not hear me swear I would not do it?
Aye, but thou usest to forswear thyself. 'Twas sin before, but now 'tis charity. What? Wilt thou not? Where's that devil's butcher, hard-favored Richard?
say I charge thee, bare hands.
So come to you and yours as to this prince.
Where's Richard gone? To London, all in post. As I guessed, to make a bloody supper at the Tower.
He's sudden if a thing comes in his head. Now, march we hence. Discharge the common source with pay and thanks.
And let's away to London. See our gentle queen, how well she fares. By this, I hope she had a son for me.
Good day, my lord. At your book so hard?
Aye, my good lord. My lord, I should say rather, 'tis sin to flatter. Good was little better. Good Gloucester and good devil were alike, and both preposterous. Therefore, not good lord.
Sirrah, leave us to ourselves. We must converse!
So flies the reckless shepherd from the wolf. So first, the helpless sheep doth yield his fleece, and next his throat unto the butcher's knife. What scene of death hath Roscius now to act?
Suspicion always haunts the guilty mind. The thief doth fear each bush an officer.
The bird that hath been limed in a bush, with trembling wings misdoubteth every bush. And I, the hapless male, to one sweet bird, have now the fatal object in my eye, where my poor young was limed, was caught, and killed.
Why, what a peevish fool was that of Crete, that taught his son the office of a fowl, and yet for all his wings the fool was drowned.
Aye, Daedalus, my poor boy Icarus, thy father Minos, that denied our corpse. The sun that seared the wings of my sweet boy, thy brother Edward, and thyself. The sea whose envious gulf did swallow up his life. Kill me with thy weapon, not with words. My breast can better brook thy dagger's point than can my ears that tragic history. But wherefore didst thou come? Is't for my life?
Think'st thou I am an executioner?
A persecutor, I am sure thou art. If murdering innocents be executing, well, then thou art an executioner.
Thy son I killed for his presumption.
Hadst thou been killed, when first thou didst presume, thou hadst not lived to kill a son of mine. And thus I prophesy, that many a thousand which now mistrust no parcel of my fear, and many an old man's sigh, and many a widow's, and many an orphan's water-standing eye. Men for their sons, wives for their husbands, orphans for their parents' timeless death, shall rue the hour that ever thou wast born. The owl shrieked at thy birth, an evil sign. The nightcrow cried, a boding, luckless time. Dogs howled, and hideous tempest shook down trees. The raven rooked her on the chimney's top. And chattering pies and dismal discord sung. Thy mother felt more than a mother's pain, yet brought forth less than a mother's hope. To wit, an indigest and deformed lump, not like the fruit of such a goodly tree. Teeth hadst thou in thy head when thou wast born, to signify thou camest to fight the world. And if the rest be true which I have heard, thou camest
to... I will overstay, pride in thy speech. For this amongst the rest was I ordained.
Aye. And for much more slaughter after this.
God forgive my sins and pardon thee.
What will the aspiring blood of Lancaster sink in the ground? And I thought it would have melted. See how my blade weeps for the poor king's death. May such purple tears be always shed for those that seek the downfall of our house. If any spark of life be yet in thee remaining, down to hell, and say I sent thee thither. I that have neither pity, love, nor fear.
Indeed, it is true that Henry told me of. For I have often heard my mother say I came into the world with my legs forward. Had I not reason to make haste, think you, and seek their ruin that usurped our right? And the midwife wondered, and the women cried, oh, Jesus bless us, he's born with teeth. And so I was, which plainly signified that I should snarl and bite and play the dog. Then, since the heavens have shaped my body so, let hell make crooked my mind to answer it. I have no brother. I am like no brother. And this word love, which graybeards call divine, be resident in men like one another, and not in me. I am myself alone. Clarence, beware. Thou keep'st me from the light, but I will sort a pitchy day for thee. For I will buzz abroad such prophecies that Edward shall be fearful of his life. And then to purge his fear, I'll be thy death. King Henry and the prince his son are gone. Clarence, thy turn is next. And then the rest, counting myself but bath till I be best. I have fried thy body in another room, and triumph, Henry, in thy day of doom.
Once more we sit in England's royal throne, repurchased with the blood of enemies. What valiant foemen, like to autumn's corn, have we mowed down in tops of all their pride. Three dukes of Somerset, threefold renown for hardy and undoubted champions. Two Cliffords as the father and the son, and two Northumberlands. Two braver warriors ne'er spurred their coursers at the trumpet's sound. And with them the two brave bears, Warwick and Montague, that in their chains fettered the kingly lion, and made the forest tremble when they roared. Thus have we swept suspicion from our seat and made our footstool of security. Come hither, Bess, and let me kiss my boy. Young Ned, for thee, thine uncles and myself have in our armors watched the winter's night, went all afoot in summer's scalding heat, that thou mightst repossess the crown in peace, and of our labors thou shalt reap the gain.
I'll blast his harvest of your head, Willane, for scarce I am looked on in the world, and this shoulder was ordained so thick to heave, and heave it shall some weight or break my back. Work thou the way, and thou shalt execute.
Clarence and Gloucester, love my lovely queen, and kiss your princely nephew, brothers both.
The duty that I owe unto your majesty, I seal upon the lips of this sweet babe.
Thanks, noble Clarence, worthy brother, thanks.
And that I love the tree from whence thou sprang. Witness the tender kiss I give the loving babe. Say in truth, so Judas kissed his master and cried all hail, when as he meant all harm.
Now am I seated as my soul delights, having my country's peace and brother's love.
What will your grace have done with Margaret?
Rainier, her father, to the King of France, hath pawned the Sicils and Jerusalem, and hither have they set it for her ransom.
Away with her, and waft her hence to France. Now what rests but that we spend the time with pompful triumph, mirthful comic shows, such as befits the pleasure of the court. Sound drums and trumpets, farewell, sour annoy, for here, I hope, begins our lasting joy.